przyznane przez ministra edukacji i nauki w ramach projektu Regionalna Inicjatywa Doskonałości w kwocie 12 milionów złotych na lata 2018-2022 znacząco przyczyniły się do rozbudowy infrastruktury Collegium Medicum i rozszerzenia prowadzonych badań. W ramach realizowanego projektu rozwijane są kluczowe obszary badawcze: profilaktyka chorób cywilizacyjnych, otyłość i zespół metaboliczny, styl życia dzieci i młodzieży dorosłych, profilaktyka uzależnień, badanie układu ruchu z wykorzystaniem nowoczesnych technik diagnostycznych, poszukiwanie metod prewencji i leczenia wybranych chorób zakaźnych. Stworzono nowe laboratoria badawcze, np. laboratorium mikrobiologii, genetyki, dietetyki, laboratorium diagnostyczne, laboratorium hodowli komórkowej, czy też ogólnouniwersytecki ośrodek badań nad chorobami trzustki. Bardzo ważny jest wzrost liczby publikacji, ale też jakości publikacji naukowej, w tym publikacji z udziałem młodej kadry. To są wysoko punktowane publikacje w czasopismach o znaczeniu międzynarodowym. Wzrasta na uczelni, na wydziale również liczba awansów naukowych. Systematycznie wzrasta liczba projektów o znaczeniu międzynarodowym, które są efektem współpracy międzynarodowej. Naukowcy zdobywają swoje doświadczenia na stażach naukowych, na wyjazdach zagranicznych, ale też przebywają na stażach naukowych w ośrodkach krajowych, prestiżowych, zdobywając doświadczenie. Wzrasta też liczba grantów, które są realizowane w wyniku wybudowanej infrastruktury, ale też zdobytego doświadczenia naukowców.
Zakład Patomorfologii Uniwersytetu Jana Kochanowskiego jako trzeci ośrodek w Polsce wdrożył cytologię na podłożu płynowym szyjki macicy wraz z oceną wirusa brodawczaka, wirusa HPV. Dało nam to podstawy do nowoczesnej profilaktyki, do dobrych publikacji i do współpracy z ośrodkami nie tylko krajowymi, ale również ośrodkami międzynarodowymi. Kadra, która jest zatrudniona, jest kadrą wysoce specjalistyczną, są to przeszkolone położne po odpowiednich kursach. Znajdujemy się w pokoju biopsji aspiracyjnej cienkiej głowy, jak i biopsji aspiracyjnej i tnącej, grubej głowy. Wykonujemy tutaj badania narządów powierzchniowych, takich jak guzy piersi, jak guzy tarczycy, węzłów chłonnych, ślinianek. Przeprowadzamy badania guzów tkanek miękkich metodą tradycyjną, jak i różnymi technikami z zakresu cytologii. Znajdujemy się na pracowni histopatologii, gdzie oferujemy pełne spektrum badań z zakresu badań cytologicznych, z zakresu badań histopatologicznych, immunologicznych, cytogenetycznych, a również badań genetycznych dla pacjentów szpitali, które z nami współpracują.
Znajdujemy się w laboratorium posturologii. To laboratorium powstało 11 lat temu. No i przez ten okres przebadaliśmy około 10 tysięcy dzieci i młodzieży z województwa świętokrzyskiego, głównie ze szkół podstawowych kieleckich, ale też badaliśmy dzieci z województwa mazowieckiego, ze szkół podstawowych z Radomia. Zresztą badaniem obejmujemy także inne grupy, nie tylko dzieci, bo badaliśmy kobiety po mastektomii, badamy osoby chore na Parkinsona, badaliśmy osoby po udarach mózgu, dzieci z deficytem mowy, z zaburzeniami integracji sensorycznej, z zaburzeniami refrakcji wzroku, także to spektrum, którym obejmujemy badanie, jest bardzo szerokie. I w tej chwili można powiedzieć, że jest to takie laboratorium posturologiczne, jakie są w Europie Zachodniej, w Stanach Zjednoczonych. Jest to jedno z lepiej wyposażonych laboratoriów posturologicznych w Polsce. Co oferujemy? Przede wszystkim skupiamy się na badaniu postawy ciała i kręgosłupa, ale całej postawy, włącznie z wadami stóp, kolan, wadami ustawienia głowy, wadami klatki piersiowej. No i oczywiście badamy kręgosłup, wykrywając postawy skoliotyczne i skoliozy. Oprócz badania postawy ciała, do którego wykorzystujemy właśnie tutaj ten aparat DIRS Formetric 4D, oprócz postawy ciała badamy także stabilność posturalną, badamy skład ciała, szukamy takich zależności między postawą ciała właśnie a zaburzeniami chodu, składem ciała, wadami refrakcji wzroku. Jesteśmy także otwarci na usługi komercyjne. Zachęcamy właśnie do odwiedzania naszej pracowni. U nas można dziecko przebadać kompleksowo urządzeniami najnowszej generacji. Stawiamy diagnozę, ale urządzenia były tak dobrane, żeby oprócz diagnozy można było na tych urządzeniach prowadzić terapię. W tej chwili jesteśmy przygotowani do badań komercyjnych, a w przyszłości planujemy także komercyjnie terapię.
I Państwo poprosili. Bardzo ładnie.
Jestem kierownikiem Laboratorium Posturologii. Znajdujemy się właśnie w tym laboratorium. Odbywa się dzisiaj szkolenie na nowo zakupionym urządzeniu, które się nazywa RoboGate. To urządzenie służy do diagnostyki i do reedukacji różnego rodzaju schorzeń, głównie neurologicznych, które zaburzają chód. Kwalifikują się tutaj do terapii głównie pacjenci neurologiczni, a więc, ale zarówno osoby dorosłe, jak i dzieci, osoby z dystrofiami, z dystoniami, z niedowładami, z porażeniem, ale także dzieci na przykład z mózgowym porażeniem dziecięcym. Szkolenie prowadzi instruktor z Turcji. Urządzenie zostało właśnie zakupione w tym kraju. Jest to najwyższej klasy urządzenie dostępne na polskim rynku, służące do diagnostyki i reedukacji chodu.
Zmówię mi, jak to zrobić, żeby skręcić w prawą stronę, bo ja widzę, że ja tak
ciągle lewą mocno
lewą, właśnie, ja nie mogę tego zrobić,
nie wiem, co bym mogła tak, jak gdyby takie ruchy do przodu, jakby pani skinęła w
prawą stronę,
no bo teraz w prawo,
bardziej pracować lewą.
Pracować lewą, ale pani stwierdziła,
że nie może. Nie może?
To zapytam, ja widzę na tym obrazie, że ciągle skręcam bardziej w lewo.
Czyli pani bardziej korzysta z prawej nogi. Obciąża pani bardziej prawej nogi. Czyli niech pani się stara równo obciążać lewą i prawą, i wtedy będzie jest linia prosta. Chyba?
A przez te dwa uchwyty metalowe.
Nie. Yeah.
O, teraz jest. Spróbujemy. Czyli zasady gry pani zna już, tak?
No teraz poszło w dół.
I co?
Zobaczcie, mocno lewa strona.
Naciskać na lewą. Nie, 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 także przeszkadza to nie. Czuję, że ja to muszę pociągnąć, ale nie czuję, że to przeszkadza.
Wiem, jak mocniej tą lewą.
No
to jest takie, że ja czuję ten ruch, a nie pojawiają się właśnie te takie, no tylko, że nawet nie wiem, już tak mi się ta stopa zaczyna czy wciąga.
Natomiast jeżeli chodzi o te trzy kroki początkowe, bez kontaktu z bieżnią, to prosilibyśmy, aby pani nie uczestniczyła aktywnie, tylko poddać się pracy urządzenia. Żeby urządzenie za panią prowadziło nogi. No, raz, dwa, dwa.
Yeah, it seems okay, right?
I od razu pani zaczyna nogą spróbować.
And the idea is patience is really so weak. Maybe we can increase.
Please it. Work in more yeah.
The right. Jest teraz to lewo prawo.
Czyli teraz muszę sforsować, jakbym sforsowała tą lewą.
Zluzowała.
Nie, także przeszkadza to nie. Czuję, że ja to muszę pociągnąć, ale nie czuję, że mi to przeszkadza.
Wiem, jak mocniej tą lewą.
So the patient tries now, tries to left, use more left leg.
Yeah, I can see it. Actually, I see in the yeah. Approximate time. Yes, you can see it.
Okay, so right now, it's
okay. Okay. For example, if the right leg is too much
because forced, I feel that the left leg is not every time. It's not the same level, so it's 100%.
Yeah. For example, if the patient cannot force to right leg, otherwise can force to right leg, so it's going to increase the 100%.
Right leg is stronger than the left.
Yeah, but it's not. We don't need to. It's, actually, we can do it the different difficulties, but same one is better, I guess.
Okay.
And actually, always in all the therapies, it can stay in the normal position.
Dzisiejsze wysoko rozwinięte społeczeństwa borykają się z falą chorób cywilizacyjnych. Choroby te w wymiarze indywidualnym znacząco obniżają jakość życia, a w wymiarze globalnym stanowią istotne obciążenie finansowe. Dlatego w ramach działalności spółki MedUni w województwie świętokrzyskim prowadzona jest poradnia dietetyczna. Poradnia skierowana jest do osób w różnym wieku, z nadwagą i otyłością, cukrzycą insulinoniezależną, zaburzeniami tolerancji glukozy lub insulinoopornością, nadciśnieniem tętniczym czy zespołem metabolicznym. Szczególnie specjalizujemy się w kompleksowym wsparciu żywieniowym na każdym etapie leczenia bariatrycznego. Przygotowanie dietetyczne nie tylko wspomaga utratę masy ciała w okresie przedoperacyjnym, prowadząc do zmniejszenia ryzyka powikłań okołozabiegowych, lecz także umożliwia optymalizację efektów operacji i prawidłowe leczenie otyłości. Nasze działania mają na celu ocenę przyzwyczajeń żywieniowych pacjentów, edukację żywieniową i wykształcenie nowych, właściwych nawyków żywieniowych, monitorowanie utraty masy ciała, identyfikację błędów żywieniowych, ustalanie indywidualnych planów żywieniowych, modyfikacje stylu życia, a także wykrywanie ewentualnych niedoborów żywieniowych poprzez ocenę zlecanych badań laboratoryjnych. Następnie uczymy, jakie są zasady rozszerzania diety po zabiegu bariatrycznym z uwzględnieniem zastosowanych metod chirurgicznego leczenia otyłości. W ramach poradni dietetycznej prowadzone są konsultacje dietetyczne, wizyty edukacyjne, wizyty kontrolne, a także warsztaty zdrowego gotowania.
W Zakładzie Żywienia i Dietetyki Instytutu Nauk o Zdrowiu Collegium Medicum prowadzone są przede wszystkim badania nad rolą zwyczajów żywieniowych i aktywności fizycznej w etiopatogenezie i terapii otyłości i zaburzeń metabolicznych. Zajmujemy się m.in. analizą tzw. wzorów żywienia. Wzory żywienia to inaczej ogół postępowania związanego z realizacją potrzeb pokarmowych człowieka. Takie podejście pozwala nam na stworzenie bardziej kompleksowego obrazu diety w populacji i pokazanie pełniejszej złożoności tej diety i jej wpływu na zdrowie człowieka. Do tej pory zidentyfikowano wzory żywieniowe w grupie 13 tysięcy dorosłych mieszkańców naszego regionu i zbadano zależności pomiędzy tymi wzorami a występowaniem komponentów zespołu metabolicznego. Aktualnie jesteśmy w trakcie realizacji kilku kolejnych projektów badawczych. Celem pierwszego z nich jest ocena czynników powiązanych z przebiegiem choroby wśród osób cierpiących na stwardnienie rozsiane. Rezultaty dotychczas prowadzonych badań nad rolą diety w przebiegu tej choroby są niejednoznaczne. Nadal brakuje także konsensusu naukowego w sprawie zaleceń żywieniowych dla tej grupy osób. Wiemy jednak, że niektóre modyfikacje diety mogą przyczynić się do poprawy wyników klinicznych, poprawy skuteczności leczenia tych pacjentów, złagodzenia objawów choroby czy poprawy jakości życia. Także jednym z celów tego projektu była identyfikacja wzorów żywienia charakterystycznych dla chorych ze stwardnieniem rozsianym. Badaliśmy także stan odżywienia, aktywność fizyczną i sprawność funkcjonalną osób ze stwardnieniem rozsianym. Kolejny projekt realizowany jest we współpracy z Katedrą Żywienia Człowieka Wydziału Biotechnologii i Nauk o Żywności Uniwersytetu Przyrodniczego we Wrocławiu. Jest to projekt, którego celem jest ocena ryzyka żywieniowego wśród polskich seniorów. Ryzyko żywieniowe jest to zespół takich czynników, które narażają daną osobę na ilościowe lub jakościowe ryzyko niedostatecznego spożycia pokarmu i w konsekwencji na ryzyko niedożywienia. Wyniki dotychczas prowadzonych badań były prowadzone głównie w warunkach szpitalnych, w domach pomocy społecznej. Natomiast, jak się okazuje, takie ryzyko żywieniowe może występować także wśród osób starszych żyjących w społeczności lokalnej, czyli może być takim bardziej powszechnym zjawiskiem. Ponadto prowadzone są badania zwyczajów żywieniowych osób kwalifikowanych do zabiegów bariatrycznych. Jest to niezmiernie ważne, ponieważ w przypadku takich osób konieczne jest wprowadzenie modyfikacji stylu życia jeszcze w okresie przedoperacyjnym. Utrata masy ciała przed planowanym zabiegiem zmniejsza ryzyko powikłań, pozwala także na lepszą kontrolę masy już po samym zabiegu. Ponadto prowadzone są badania nad sposobem żywienia, stanem odżywienia i aktywnością fizyczną dzieci z zespołem Downa, dzieci ze spektrum autyzmu. Materiały tutaj są zbierane w ramach przygotowania dwóch rozpraw doktorskich z tej dziedziny. W Zakładzie Żywienia i Dietetyki współpracujemy z wieloma zagranicznymi ośrodkami badawczymi, między innymi z Katedrą Edukacji Kinezjologicznej Uniwersytetu w Zagrzebiu w Chorwacji, z Wydziałem Pracy Społecznej i Zdrowia Brandenburskiego Uniwersytetu Technicznego w Senftenbergu w Niemczech, a także Wydziałem Zdrowia Uniwersytetu Katolickiego w Różomberku w Republice Słowackiej. Wspólne badania dotyczą m.in. czynników ryzyka nadwagi i otyłości i zaburzeń metabolicznych wśród studentów uczelni wyższych. W ramach projektu Erasmus+, jesteśmy także uczestnikiem międzynarodowego projektu Digital Lab for Education in Dietetics. Projekt ten jest realizowany przy współpracy z uczelniami z takich krajów jak Hiszpania, Portugalia, Belgia, Austria. Projekt polega na stworzeniu przy użyciu sztucznej inteligencji awatarów, czyli takich wirtualnych pacjentów, takich cyfrowych narzędzi szkoleniowych, które pozwolą nam na bardziej innowacyjne, nowatorskie szkolenie studentów dietetyki w symulowanym środowisku pracy. Jest to projekt na razie dydaktyczny, ale oczywiście planujemy tutaj dalszą, już bardziej naukową współpracę w tym zakresie.
Zakład oferuje pełną i nowoczesną diagnostykę w zakresie patomorfologii, która jest potrzebna dla skutecznej terapii, szczególnie w przebiegu chorób nowotworowych. Dysponujemy nowoczesną aparaturą, która umożliwia nam wykonanie badań od podstaw, czyli tak naprawdę od momentu, kiedy materiał zostaje pobrany w szpitalu, do wydania szkiełka histopatologicznego, które diagnozowane jest przez lekarzy patomorfologów. Dysponujemy oczywiście również wykwalifikowaną kadrą, która umożliwia w znaczący sposób przeprowadzenie tych badań. W naszym zakładzie znajdują się pracownie, takie jak pracownia podstawowej histologii, gdzie materiał jest krojony i barwiony, ale także pracownia cytologii, w której do dyspozycji mamy różne metody cytologiczne, między innymi tak zwana cytologia LBC, Liquid Based Cytology, czyli cytologia na podłożu płynnym. Mamy również możliwość wykonywania badań pod kątem wirusologicznym. Nasz zakład był pionierem na nasze województwo, właśnie w projekcie realizowanym dla pań pod kątem cytologii płynowej, a także pod kątem badań wirusa HPV, czyli wirusa brodawczaka ludzkiego. Pracownia również posiada sprzęt do tzw. immunohistochemii, na którym wykonujemy właśnie badania. Głównie ten obszar badań naukowych jest realizowany za pomocą badań immunohistochemicznych. Wykonujemy również pewne badania z obszaru biologii molekularnej, między innymi fluorescencja in situ, czyli tak zwany FISH, który pozwala nam tutaj rozwinąć właśnie w znaczący sposób badania naukowe dla zainteresowanych lekarzy. Pracownia świadczy również usługi komercyjne, czyli dla pacjentów. Mamy podpisane umowy z kilkoma szpitalami z naszego województwa. Świadczymy po prostu usługi z zakresu badań patomorfologicznych dla pacjentów, od podstawowych badań, po te, o których już mówiłam, rozwinięte badania na poziomie immunohistochemii, czy też na poziomie badań molekularnych. Zakład również przeprowadza badania śródoperacyjne, które są niezbędne w diagnostyce patomorfologicznej. Posiadamy kadrę złożoną z diagnostów laboratoryjnych, lekarzy, laborantów i dzięki temu, że mamy kadrę, dzięki temu, że jest sprzęt, nasze badania są zawsze wykonywane na najwyższym poziomie.
Znajdujemy się w pracowni genetyki medycznej, która należy do Katedry Medycyny Zabiegowej. Wykonujemy tutaj czynności głównie związane z badaniami wykorzystującymi techniki biologii molekularnej, czyli przede wszystkim analizujemy kwasy nukleinowe, analizujemy pod względem ilości, pod względem jakości, pod względem struktury. Merytorycznie zajmujemy się przede wszystkim badaniem uwarunkowań genetycznych chorób trzustki. Poszukujemy różnorodnych mutacji, polimorfizmów, które mogłyby odpowiedzieć na pytanie, jakie uwarunkowania genetyczne mogą być związane, czy jakie geny, jakie regiony w genomie ludzkim mogą być związane z chorobami trzustki. Oprócz tego zajmujemy się również innymi zagadnieniami naukowymi, jak na przykład badamy uwarunkowania, znaczy może raczej mechanizmy patogenności bakterii, przede wszystkim Escherichia coli, ale również innych patogenów dróg moczowych, głównie na tym się skupiamy. Uwarunkowania genetyczne również na poziomie molekularnym, czyli poszukujemy determinantów genetycznych w obrębie genomu bakterii, które mogłyby również wpływać na zjadliwość bakterii, na jej mechanizmy adaptacyjne, na to, w jaki sposób te bakterie przystosowują się do środowiska, żeby być bardziej zjadliwą bakterią, być bardziej bakterią odporną na leki przeciwdrobnoustrojowe. W tym momencie współpracujemy również, w tym kontekście przede wszystkim, współpracujemy z Uniwersytetem Gdańskim, gdzie poszukujemy bakteriofagów, to są takie wirusy bakteryjne, które mogłyby te bakterie atakować, unicestwiać, co mogłoby być później może wykorzystane jako jakaś terapia alternatywna dla antybiotyków. Ale również zgłębiamy się bardziej tak w kontekście mechanizmów CRISP, ponieważ wiemy, że mechanizmy CRISP to są, mechanizmy, regiony CRISP, to są takie regiony, które są takim swoistym układem immunologicznym bakterii i chcemy znaleźć powiązanie pomiędzy tymi mechanizmami, pomiędzy tymi regionami, pomiędzy bakteriofagami, które to bardzo mocno są związane z tymi regionami CRISP, a patogennością bakterii. Chcemy znaleźć wspólną tutaj nić i poszukiwać dalej tych mechanizmów patogenności. Dzisiaj natomiast przygotowujemy biblioteki do sekwencjonowania mikrobiomu ludzkiego pozyskiwanego z kału. Jest to projekt pod kierownictwem pani profesor Kozieł. No i tak jak mówiłam, przygotowujemy dzisiaj biblioteki po to, żeby sekwencjonować mikrobiom ludzki i zobaczyć, jak ten mikrobiom, skład tego mikrobiomu koreluje z pewnymi parametrami klinicznymi.
Nazywam się dr Sylwia Trpiłowska, pracuję w Katedrze Medycyny Zabiegowej z Pracownią Genetyki Medycznej na Uniwersytecie Jana Kochanowskiego w Kielcach. Swoje badania prowadzę z użyciem modelu badawczego, jakim są komórki zwierzęce. Są to zarówno linie ustalone, które są dostępne komercyjnie i są to często modele wielu chorób, w tym chorób nowotworowych, ale również prowadzę je z udziałem komórek wyizolowanych bezpośrednio ze zmienionych chorobowo tkanek pacjenta. Takie badania dają nam bardzo wiele możliwości, ponieważ możemy z jednej strony określić czynniki ryzyka wielu chorób, możemy stwierdzić, co było powodem tego, iż komórka prawidłowa wyszła na drogę transformacji nowotworowej. Możemy dokładnie określić również mechanizmy zachodzące wewnątrz komórki, to zarówno na poziomie organeli komórkowych, jak i poszczególnych molekuł, na przykład DNA. A z drugiej strony możemy również zaproponować terapię pacjentowi. Jak wiadomo, pacjenci, nawet chorujący na tę samą chorobę, różnią się między sobą, chociażby w przebiegu choroby, ale również reakcji na chemioterapię. I prowadzenie hodowli komórkowych od tych pacjentów umożliwia z jednej strony przebadanie dokładnych mechanizmów, które spowodowały powstanie danej choroby, ale z drugiej strony umożliwia też zastosowanie optymalnej terapii. Z użyciem hodowli komórkowych możemy badać bardzo wiele cząsteczek o potencjale terapeutycznym. Taka cząsteczka, zanim stanie się lekiem, musi przejść bardzo wiele badań. Pierwszym tym etapem tych badań są badania bezpieczeństwa i badania te robimy na hodowlach komórkowych. Badania te polegają na określeniu z jednej strony mechanizmów działania danej cząsteczki, zarówno na poziomie organeli, ale też na poziomie pojedynczych molekuł, a z drugiej strony umożliwiają określenie bezpieczeństwa, czyli czy dana cząsteczka będzie toksyczna, czy nie będzie toksyczna dla komórek prawidłowych organizmu. Wszystkie badania, które prowadzimy, prowadzimy zgodnie z normami ISO oraz wytycznymi OECD. Znaczy to tyle, że badania te oprócz niewątpliwej wartości poznawczej mają też wartość aplikacyjną. Przeprowadzenie ich w reżimie procedur ISO czy OECD powoduje, że takie wyniki badań możemy używać również w procesie rejestracji nowych leków, a badanie bezpieczeństwa na hodowlach in vitro zgodnie ze wszystkimi wytycznymi Unii Europejskiej jest konieczne do wejścia w fazę badań przedklinicznych, a następnie klinicznych i później rejestracji leku.
Thank you.
Na pewno bardzo dużo jeszcze mamy do zrobienia, ale wybudowana infrastruktura medyczna, infrastruktura do badań naukowych, ale też doświadczenie kadry na pewno przyczyni się do rozwoju badań prowadzonych w Collegium Medicum.
Świętokrzyskie. Naturalnie.
Szanowni Państwo, jest nam niezmiernie powitać Państwa na pierwszej międzynarodowej konferencji dotyczącej diabetologii w Collegium Medicum Uniwersytetu Jana Kochanowskiego w Kielcach. Honorable guests, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen. I, Justyna Krusek, and my co-host Marcin Sadowski, we have a great pleasure to welcome you in Jan Kochanowski University. As we are streaming live, good afternoon to all connected online.
We are extremely thrilled to address you on the occasion of the first international conference in our university. The significance of diabetes has been well noticed by international societies, as more than 400 million people have diabetes worldwide. A total number of deaths attributed to diabetes exceeds 4 million annually. Therefore, we all have assembled today to improve our skills and exchange up-to-date information.
Today's meeting is attended by speakers from Australia, Denmark, and of course Poland, representing bench and bedside experts in the field of endocrinology, surgery, diabetology, together with molecular biology. We will also have the presentation on the diabetes treatment reimbursement prepared by our English division students from different European Union countries. Finally, we will conclude with panel discussions. Questions from the audience, both present here and online participants, are warmly welcome. Therefore, this conference will provide us essential knowledge and a great opportunity to share experiences.
This is an opportune time to declare the official opening of the current opinion in diabetes, challenges and hopes for the 21st century. We wish you fruitful hours of interesting and beneficial program and a pleasant stay in Kielce.
Szanowni Państwo, niemniej dzisiejszą konferencję uznajemy za otwartą. Pozwólcie Państwo, że zaprosimy pierwszego prelegenta dzisiejszego spotkania, pana profesora Stanisława Głuszka.
It's a great pleasure for me to introduce the first speaker today, who is going to talk about the current options of bariatric surgery. He's a specialist in general and oncologic surgery, also a provincial consultant for general surgery, and of course, director of our university. His area of expertise includes the epidemiology and genetic determination of pancreatic inflammation and cancer, as well as research in metabolic syndrome and obesity treatment. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Stanisław Głuszek.
Dzień dobry Państwu, bardzo dziękuję za obdarzenie mnie tą przyjemnością i obowiązkiem wygłoszenia wykładu Współczesne możliwości leczenia chirurgicznego otyłości. Wiadomo, że problem jest narastający, tak jak narastające są tutaj te postaci idące w kierunku wyższego BMI. I wiemy o tym, że według badania Idea Poland i NatPol 1/4 mniej więcej społeczeństwa to są osoby z nadwagą i z otyłością. Jeżeli bierzemy pod uwagę bardzo dokładne dane z Polmoniki, to otyłość dotyczy 22% ponad u mężczyzn i prawie 30% kobiet. I oczywiście z tą otyłością związane są nadciśnienie, insulinooporność, cukrzyca, dyslipidemia. I oczywiście wiemy o tym, że ponad 60% badanych nigdy lub prawie nigdy nie uprawia ćwiczeń. Problemem epidemiologicznym jest cukrzyca, o tym będzie jeszcze bardzo dużo mowy podczas dzisiejszego spotkania dotyczącego cukrzycy, ale te dane pochodzące z Instytutu Praw Pacjenta i Edukacji Zdrowotnej mówią o tym, jaki to jest problem, że to jest około 3 milionów, może już więcej, jeżeli chodzi o epidemiologię cukrzycy. Jeżeli mówimy o otyłości, ta, która podlega właściwie działaniu chirurgicznemu, to w tej chwili w skali Polski mówimy o mniej więcej 1% osób dorosłych, czyli 300 tysięcy chorych w Polsce, którzy potencjalnie mogliby być poddani leczeniu operacyjnemu, a wykonywanych takich zabiegów operacyjnych bariatrycznych jest około 4-5 tysięcy. W wybranych populacjach ten odsetek jest jeszcze większy. za wskazanie do chirurgicznego leczenia na dzień dzisiejszy według danych evidence-based medicine właściwie na całym świecie przyjęto, że stan, w którym wskaźnik masy ciała przekracza wartość 40 kg na metr kwadratowy, i to mówimy wtedy o otyłości trzeciego stopnia, ten drugi stopień 35 kg i wyżej na metr kwadratowy, wtedy, kiedy występują dodatkowe choroby zależne od otyłości, i tego trzymamy się w praktycznym leczeniu, dlatego że to chodzi również o refundację funduszu, Narodowego Funduszu Zdrowia. Z chirurgicznego punktu widzenia, jeżeli podkreślamy ten problem, to mówimy o otyłości olbrzymiej, nawet mówimy tak otyłość złośliwa, co świadczy o tym, że jest to naprawdę bardzo groźna choroba i z nią mamy do czynienia w praktyce chirurgicznej. Właściwie ta otyłość olbrzymia czy superotyłość nie poddają się leczeniu farmakologicznemu, przynajmniej w moim doświadczeniu około 500 tych chorych to leczenie farmakologiczne i zachowawcze nie odniosło skutku i te chore, ci chorzy byli leczeni chirurgicznie. Tak więc mówiąc właściwie o otyłości, mówimy ciągle, czy myślimy o zespole metabolicznym. Mówimy o tej upośledzonej tolerancji glukozy, bo to większości chorych dotyczy, zaburzeń lipidowych, nadciśnienia tętniczego, czy rzeczywiście pewnym stanie prozapalnym, prozakrzepowym. Także mamy do czynienia z chorym, który naprawdę jest chory i obarczony różnymi problemami, jeżeli chodzi również o przygotowanie chorego do zabiegu operacyjnego. Te dwa problemy związane z tym zespołem metabolicznym, a więc otyłość i insulinooporność, to jest kluczowy jak gdyby problem dotyczący tych zagadnień zespołu metabolicznego, ale mówimy o predyspozycjach genetycznych, czynnikach środowiskowych, oczywiście diecie aterogennej czy małej aktywności fizycznej, o czym już wspominałem. I wreszcie zwiększającej się roli adipokin, które również odgrywają jakąś znaczącą rolę. Oczywiście posługujemy się różnorakimi kryteriami, jeżeli chodzi o zespół metaboliczny, ale my najczęściej stosujemy w naszych i pracach naukowych, i w naszych dociekaniach, i nawet w praktyce klinicznej te dwie wyeksponowane tu, czyli to ATP3 w skrócie i International Diabetes Federation. Te kryteria rozpoznania zespołu metabolicznego właściwie są wszystkim znane, ale wiadomo, że to otyłość brzuszna wód talii pochodzących z Europy mężczyzn 94 cm i wyżej, u kobiet 80 i wyżej, i dodatkowo co najmniej dwa z poniższych odchyleń, a więc trójglicerydemia, niski HDL czy ciśnienie tętnicze powyżej 130/80 i glikemia na czczo 100 i więcej, czy leczenie cukrzycy. Ale mówiąc o leczeniu bariatrycznym, mówimy o pewnym programie, bo musimy mieć pewien program zaplanowany, żeby można było mówić odpowiedzialnie o leczeniu otyłości. Powinien to być wielodyscyplinarny zespół, po pierwsze, dietetyk, terapia behawioralna bardzo ważna, musimy przebudować w głowie problem rzeczywiście myślenia i podejścia do odżywiania, żebyśmy mogli mówić o leczeniu bariatrycznym również, terapia ruchowa, farmakoterapia i wreszcie skoncentrowana na otyłości chirurgia jako ten piąty element, który jest bardzo ważnym elementem, ale te cztery wcześniejsze elementy są również ważne w okresie pooperacyjnym. I wreszcie teraz rodzi się nowy paradygmat, czy zrodził się już paradygmat leczenia endoskopowego, czyli tę chirurgię inwazyjną, czy nawet laparoskopową, czy robotową, być może będzie można w dużej mierze zastąpić leczeniem endoskopowym. Na dzień dzisiejszy można powiedzieć tak, że chirurgiczne leczenie otyłości jest współcześnie jedyną skuteczną metodą leczenia chorych z otyłością i chorobami będącymi jej następstwem jako powikłaniami. To są właśnie przykłady chorych, że na pewno leczenie zachowawcze nie będzie miało efektu korzystnego. To jest chora, która 66 BMI, nadciśnienie, artralgię, no ale w holterze 14-sekundowe przerwy. Tutaj nie można w ogóle ryzykować leczenie chirurgiczne, bo to jest leczeniem chirurgicznym na tym etapie stanu kardiologicznego, bo to oczywiście mogłoby się skończyć dramatycznym niepowodzeniem. A zatem mówiąc o chirurgii otyłości, mówimy właśnie o trzech rodzajach chirurgii. Chirurgia otyłości jako obesity surgery, diabetes surgery, chirurgia cukrzycy i wreszcie mówimy o chirurgii zespołu metabolicznego. To pojęcie chirurgii zespołu metabolicznego to jest rok 2010. W Polsce właśnie my organizowaliśmy drugą konferencję metaboliczną w 2010 roku i właściwie to wtedy jak gdyby było wyeksponowane pojęcie tej chirurgii metabolicznej, to co w tej chwili uprawiamy. Otyłość wiadomo, że jest związana z częstszym występowaniem poważnych chorób oraz zwiększonym ryzykiem śmierci w stosunku do populacji nieobciążonej tą chorobą i według badań Piszona i współpracowników otyłość ogólna i brzuszna zwiększa ryzyko śmierci. Będę się do tego odwoływał jeszcze w kolejnych pracach, które będę cytował. Wiemy również na podstawie amerykańskich badań, że przewidywany czas życia u chorych, którzy mają BMI powyżej 30, jest krótszy od 5 do 20 lat, a więc jest to bardzo długi okres czasu. Jest o co walczyć, lecząc otyłość. Zmiany metabolizmu po zabiegach bariatrycznych, które obserwujemy i rzeczywiście to są spektakularne bardzo często zmiany, dotyczą zdecydowanej większości chorych, to zmiana przebiegu cukrzycy na korzystniejszą albo zupełnie rezolucję. Inne czynniki ryzyka sercowo-naczyniowego i zaburzenia lipidowe i regulacja tych zaburzeń, objawy chorób sercowo-naczyniowych, czy zmiana nawet pogrubienia intima media, bezdechy senne, bóle stawowe, czy wreszcie ogólna jakość życia związana ze zdrowiem. Bardzo ważne prace, które chciałbym tu przedstawić, na których się opieramy, to praca Siestrema z 2007 roku, która ma pewną kontynuację w ostatnich latach. Te badania były przeprowadzone w latach 87-2001, pacjenci w grupie do 60 roku życia, BMI 34 w przypadku mężczyzn i 38 w przypadku kobiet. I wiemy o tym, że w tej grupie to wiązało się z podwojeniem ryzyka przedwczesnej śmierci w związku z otyłością. Było w tych grupach, rzeczywiście to były bardzo liczebne grupy, 2010 poddanych chirurgii bariatrycznej, różne metody chirurgiczne stosowane, nad tym się nie będę skupiał w tej chwili, i podobna grupa leczonych zachowawczo. Największy ubytek masy ciała był obserwowany w ciągu pierwszych 2 lat po operacji. To przedstawia świetnie ten wykres. Widać, jak tutaj właśnie te pierwsze 2 lata są najkorzystniejsze. Oczywiście później, w zależności od bardziej radykalnej metody, sytuacja utrzymuje się czy niewiele się pogarsza, natomiast im metoda jest mniej, że tak powiem, radykalna, tym ten wskaźnik idzie do góry. No i oczywiście kontrola, tu praktycznie nie ma żadnych zmian. W okresie obserwacji w tych grupach ponad 2000 zmarło 129 pacjentów w grupie kontrolnej, 101 w grupie operowanych i najczęstsze przyczyny śmierci to ostre incydenty sercowo-naczyniowe i choroby nowotworowe. Tak więc z tej ważnej pracy wynika, że chirurgia bariatryczna przy ciężkich postaciach otyłości wiąże się ze zmniejszeniem masy ciała i zmniejszeniem ryzyka zgonów, bo to nie tylko chodzi o kosmetykę, można powiedzieć w dużym skrócie, ale właśnie o zmniejszenie ryzyka zgonów i zmniejszenie chorobowości. Obecnie jest to jedyna metoda leczenia dająca rzeczywiście trwałe efekty w postaci redukcji masy. I to jest dla nas bardzo ważne uzasadnienie dla podjęcia pewnych agresywnych działań, bo chirurgia bądź co bądź jest agresywną metodą leczenia, nawet laparoskopowa czy robotowa, do podjęcia wyzwania dla chirurgii bariatrycznej. Druga praca, która również ma kluczowe i uzasadnienie dla podjęcia tych działań bariatrycznych, to praca Adamsa i zespołu ze Stanów Zjednoczonych, gdzie stosowano głównie przęsłowanie żołądka sposobem RUEN-Y. I właściwie te prace również są bardzo istotne, jeżeli chodzi o wyniki. Prawie 10 tysięcy pacjentów leczonych tą metodą i 10 tysięcy pacjentów, którzy nie byli leczeni, czyli byli obserwowani, tacy, którzy ubiegali się o prawo jazdy. Średni czas obserwacji 7,1 lat. I w okresie obserwacji zmarło 213 chorych operowanych i znacznie więcej, bo ponad 300 chorych z grupy kontrolnej. W czasie tej obserwacji, to jest bardzo istotne, zmniejszyła się śmiertelność o 40% w grupie operowanych w porównaniu z grupą kontrolną i o 56% z powodu ostrych incydentów wieńcowych, z powodu powikłań cukrzycy i z powodu chorób nowotworowych. Według tej pracy ten wniosek jest bardzo istotny, że pooperacyjna redukcja masy ciała w okresie obserwacji zapobiegła 171 zgonom w przeliczeniu na 10 tysięcy pacjentów operowanych. Jak wyglądają polskie rekomendacje dotyczące zasad właśnie stosowania chirurgii bariatrycznej? To są prace, które jestem też współautorem, te rekomendacje 2016 roku. To jest między innymi Andrzej Budzyński, Kraków, Piotr Major, Kraków, Stanisław Głuszek i między innymi jest Mariusz Wyleżał, który również gościł u nas na wydziale i który również miał wpływ na kształt naszej chirurgii bariatrycznej, czy wreszcie profesor Krzysztof Paśnik, który również był przy pierwszym zabiegu w 2008 roku, jeżeli chodzi o leczenie chorych z otyłością. Jeszcze raz, według tych wytycznych, które są obowiązujące dla nas, wskazania do chirurgicznego leczenia to właśnie BMI powyżej 40, czy 35 do 40, jeżeli są choroby, które są wywołane otyłością. Musimy mieć te dwie choroby udokumentowane, żeby Narodowy Fundusz Zdrowia zrefundował nam te działania operacyjne. I wreszcie to trzecie wskazanie, bardzo istotne, wiążące się z dzisiejszą konferencją, to niższe BMI z cukrzycą typu drugiego w przypadku utrzymywania się hiperglikemii mimo stosowania leków doustnych oraz insuliny. To jest wytyczny, które obowiązują na dzień dzisiejszy, jeżeli chodzi o wskazania do leczenia chirurgicznego. I wreszcie wcześniejsze zabiegi bariatryczne bez osiągniętego efektu, to jest bardzo przykre dla chirurga i dla chorego, ale to się również wiąże z zachowaniami i z całym behawiorem, jak to wczoraj widzieliśmy zakład w Instytucie Genetyki i Biotechnologii Zwierząt, zakład behawioru i dobrostanu zwierząt. Także tutaj ten behawior, jeżeli chodzi o otyłość, jest również bardzo istotny i przebudowa myślenia i odczuwania pewnych stanów emocjonalnych jest niezwykle ważna w postępowaniu bariatrycznym. Zabiegi bariatryczne wykonujemy według tych wytycznych i to jest zasadne do 65 roku życia. Możemy po 65 roku życia, ale musimy przeanalizować stan biologiczny, czy rzeczywiście mieć bardzo wysokie prawdopodobieństwo, że ten stan biologiczny będzie determinował dobry efekt czy powodzenie po leczeniu operacyjnym. Oczywiście przeciwwskazania bezwzględne do zabiegów. Chirurgia, tak jak mówię, jest wymagająca i choroby nieuleczalne stanowiące zagrożenie dla życia, czy ciężkie zaburzenia krzepnięcia i inne tutaj wymienione w ogóle mówią o tym, że nie możemy stosować zabiegów bariatrycznych, co dla nas jest oczywiste. Są przeciwwskazania względne, które można zamienić czy zlikwidować i można podjąć się również działań operacyjnych, zwłaszcza jeżeli mamy na uwadze takie przypadki, jak te, które przedstawiałem na początku. Zawsze musimy działać w zespole wielodyscyplinarnym. Jeżeli chcemy stosować zasady współczesnej bariatrii, powinniśmy mieć na uwadze dobrą współpracę z internistą, z anestezjologiem, z dietetykiem przed i po operacji, z psychologiem odpowiednio do tego przygotowanym i wreszcie z całym zespołem pielęgniarek i pracowników socjalnych. Oczywiście ten tutaj internista to myślimy diabetolog, kardiolog, hipertensjolog, pulmonolog, także cały panel internistów od diabetologa począwszy jest bardzo ważny w przygotowaniu i właśnie w kierowaniu całym tym procesem. Jeżeli mówimy tylko, że sam chirurg ma się zajmować bariatrią, to niedobrze. To wtedy te efekty na pewno nie będą odpowiednie, bo to psycholog i lekarz powinien, chirurg, uświadomić chorym, że musimy przebudować zmianę myślenia, żeby rzeczywiście ten efekt bariatrii był pożądany i taki oczekiwany. Jeżeli mówimy o leczeniu operacyjnym, to właściwie mamy na uwadze cztery takie grupy zabiegów. Operacje restrykcyjne, od tego zaczynaliśmy, od regulowanej opaski żołądkowej, którą w tej chwili rzadko się stosuje, ale ta metoda jest dopuszczalna i jest stosowana. Operacje wyłączające, które są operacjami takimi bardzo zaawansowanymi i najczęściej stosujemy w tej chwili z tej grupy operacje restrykcyjne wyłączające resekcję rękawową żołądka, rzadziej przęsłowanie żołądka, czyli tą operację Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. To jest przykład właśnie gastric banding, czyli tej regulowanej opaski żołądkowej, którą stosujemy już teraz rzadko, ale na początku od tego zaczynaliśmy. Tu zakłada się opaskę, którą się odpowiednio tam zapina, następnie ta opaska jest w tej chwili przeciągana. Nie chciałbym tego przedłużać, ale ten zabieg wygląda dość spektakularnie. Następnie jak już tą opaskę się zapnie, oprzywa się ją dwoma, trzema szwami, żeby się nie przemieściła, żeby nie było takiego zejścia tej opaski w kierunku przełyku, albo też w drugą stronę, w kierunku dolnej części żołądka. I tak jak mówię, tę operację stosujemy w tej chwili rzadko, natomiast operacją, która jest nadal, można powiedzieć, na topie, ale w bardziej zaawansowanych stopniach otyłości, czy w pewnych szczególnych wskazaniach, to jest operacja przesuwania żołądka, czyli operacja Roux-en-Y gastric bypass. Mały żołądek, jak Państwo widzicie tutaj na tym schemacie, 50 ml pomieści, także nie możemy dużo wypić i zjeść. Następnie połączenie takie właśnie z pętlą jelita cienkiego, tutaj następnie połączenie tej pętli oddwunastniczej. Długością tych pętli reguluje się skuteczność zaburzeń wchłaniania, czyli najczęściej to jest 150-150 i wtedy istotnie zostaje jeszcze 150-200 tej wspólnej drogi pokarmowej. To jest zabieg, który tutaj w moim wykonaniu, właśnie fragmenty tego zabiegu są zabieg, który no jest zabiegiem zaawansowanym i rzeczywiście skutecznym w większości przypadków otyłości. I zabieg, który jest najczęściej wykonywany, który też ma wysoką skuteczność, to jest resekcja rękawowa żołądka. Mówi się o tym, że to jest najdłuższy szew w chirurgii, bo rzeczywiście tu się zakłada 6-7 staplerów wzdłuż całej krzywizny żołądka. Tą część oczywiście żołądka się usuwa, czyli można powiedzieć, że zabieg tutaj jest nieodwracalny, w odróżnieniu od tamtej operacji, że gdyby sobie pacjent życzył, a czasem sobie życzą pacjenci, to można odwrócić i przywrócić anatomię. Tutaj natomiast tą część żołądka musimy usunąć i zostawiamy taki rękaw, który jest rzeczywiście wystarczający do tego, żeby stosować odpowiednią restrykcję, ale też, żeby wpływać na zaburzenia wchłaniania. I to jest żołądek właśnie po wycięciu, ta część, która została wyjęta od chorego. Tak to wygląda oczywiście w zależności od sytuacji, od konkretnego przypadku chorego. A to jest chory już po wielu miesiącach, po usunięciu fałdu skórnotłuszczowego, czy usunięcia kilku kilogramów tego fałdu. A to jest taki efekt spektakularny, ale bardzo często do czynienia właśnie mamy z takimi chorymi. Czyli chora schudła w ciągu roku, półtora roku, 50 kg, ustąpienie cukrzycy, no i tak wygląda, jak to jest przedstawione na tym zdjęciu. Oceniamy oczywiście skuteczność leczenia chirurgicznego, bo ta skuteczność dla chirurga jest bardzo ważna. Jeżeli 80-90% chorych, operowanych, będzie właśnie podlegać tym zasadom, to będzie dobrze. Czyli utrata powyżej 25% wyjściowej masy ciała, utrata co najmniej 50% nadwagi, czy tej nadmiarowej, to jest bardzo ważny wskaźnik. I tym się kierujemy i tego oczekujemy od pacjentów, żeby z nami odpowiednio współpracowali. Czy tak, mówiąc o podsumowaniu pewnej części wykładu, czy jest naukowe uzasadnienie dla chirurgii bariatrycznej? Proszę zwrócić uwagę, że praca, która tutaj jest cytowana, praca Carlsona z 2020, ona nawiązuje do właśnie tej grupy Siestrema i odpowiednio te grupy pacjentów, które tu Państwo macie pokazane, były przebadane do 31 grudnia 2018 roku. Mediana obserwacji była oszałamiająca, bo wynosiła 24 lata w grupie operowanej i 22 lata w grupie kontrolnej. I dane dotyczyły prawie 100%, bo 99,9% pacjentów uczestniczących w badaniu. Body mass index był porównywalny, oczywiście w stosunku do tej grupy referencyjnej to wiadomo, natomiast co uzyskaliśmy dzięki tym badaniom Siestrema i Carlsona? Otóż w kohorcie referencyjnej mediana czasu trwania obserwacji trwała 20 lat, dane dotyczące 100% uczestników praktycznie, śmiertelność 0,2%, czyli bardzo niska, ale jednak jest pewna śmiertelność na 2005 chorych. I proszę zwrócić uwagę, że oczekiwana długość życia w grupie operowanych była o 3 lata niższa niż w grupie kontrolnej, czy tych otyłych nieoperowanych, ale niestety o 5,5 roku krótsza niż w populacji ogólnej. Czyli nawet ta otyłość, która trwała przez pewien okres czasu i była zlikwidowana, ona również ma wpływ na los tych chorych i to trzeba brać pod uwagę również przy tej kontroli czy przy kwalifikacji do leczenia operacyjnego. I u pacjentów z otyłością operacja bariatryczna wiązała się z dłuższą oczekiwaną długością życia niż zwykła opieka nad otyłością i śmiertelność pozostała wyższa w obu grupach niż w populacji ogólnej. I kolejne prace, które mówią również o tym, że chorych dojrzewających, tak, w okresie adolescencji, jeżeli wcześniej leczymy, to jest większa szansa na remisję cukrzycy i remisję nadciśnienia. I teraz mówiąc o paradygmacie otyłości, mówiliśmy o tej części chirurgicznej, którą można wykonywać w sposób otwarty, ale wykonujemy laparoskopowo, a nawet częściowo robotowo już w tej chwili, to ten paradygmat endoskopii być może w przyszłości zastąpi w całokształcie chirurgię. Balony żołądkowe, to jest to, co stosujemy już w tej chwili jako pomoc do chirurgii laparoskopowej czy do chirurgii otwartej, ale głównie laparoskopowej. Zasada działania to wiadomo, wypełnienie przestrzeni żołądka, zmniejszenie pojemności żołądka, rozciągnięcie żołądka i przez te pierwsze 4, 5, 6 miesięcy rzeczywiście u dużej części chorych osiągamy dobry efekt, ale jeżeli chory nie ma przebudowanej psychiki, nie jest przygotowany do tego działania, to wtedy nie osiągamy tego efektu w dalszych etapach. Dalej endoskopowa, rękawowa gastroplastyka, to co może zastąpić w przyszłości, już częściowo zastępuje resekcję rękawową żołądka. I wreszcie ten zabieg ma zmniejszać objętość żołądka analogicznie do rękawowej resekcji żołądka. To pominiemy, bo tu jest właśnie schemat, który dość długo trwa. I kolejny jak gdyby etap, czy kolejna część tej endoskopii to endoskopowe urządzenia omijające przewód pokarmowy, czyli takie urządzenia barierowe, które ograniczają wchłanianie w bliższym odcinku jelita cienkiego. To są również próby tego typu, które stosuje się właściwie na szeroką skalę w badaniach doświadczalnych klinicznych. I kolejna to jest operacja, która będzie operacją odwracalną w stosunku do operacji resekcyjnej gastrektomii, tej rękawowej, dlatego że tutaj będziemy mogli założyć taki klips bez przecinania żołądka, mechanizm całkowicie odwracalny i będziemy mogli osiągnąć również efekt tej resekcji rękawowej. I wreszcie, proszę Państwa, jak jesteśmy w ogóle bezradni, to również uwzględnia się coś takiego, bo niektórzy chorzy nieprzygotowani ani fizycznie, ani psychicznie, ani psychoterapeutycznie nie potrafią sobie z tym poradzić i nawet stosuje się wyjątkowo ekstra przypadkach terapię aspiracyjną, czyli chory zjada, zaspokaja głód, a można stosować taką terapię aspiracyjną, która to powoduje. Powoduje ten ubytek masy ciała. Oczywiście powikłania po leczeniu bariatycznym i wczesne, i późne, jak po każdej chirurgii, oczywiście one są specyficzne. I powikłania odległe, wiadomo, że z niedożywieniem, z deficytami żelaza, kwasu foliowego, czy wreszcie z kamicą żółciową, czy metaboliczną chorobą kości, o czym będzie pani doktor Brzozowska mówić. To są wszystko problemy, które wymagają również odpowiedniego zespołu i ustawienia w okresie pooperacyjnym. I wreszcie przechodząc do ostatniego aspektu tej części wykładu, to wysoka skuteczność chirurgii bariatycznej w leczeniu cukrzycy. Pierwsze badania Buchwalda, całkowite ustąpienie cukrzycy u 3/4 chorych po chirurgii bariatycznej, po resekcji RUEN-Y gastric pipe 84%. Kolejne badania Bredhauera, całkowita remisja została zdefiniowana jako hemoglobina glikowana do 6%, czy stężenie glukozy we krwi nadczo poniżej 100 mg. Procent. I tutaj wydaje się, że GLP-1 ma liczne efekty metaboliczne. Ważne to zdolność do zwiększania funkcji komórkowych komórek beta, szybsze wchłanianie substancji odżywczej w dystalnym odcinku jelita cienkiego powoduje wzrost trzykrotny GLP-1, który jest wydzielany przez komórki jelita oraz poprawia funkcję komórek beta i wrażliwość na insulinę. I to wykorzystujemy, dlatego że te stężenia czy aktywność GLP-1 zwiększa się po resekcji rękawowej i RUEN-Y gastric bypass, co sugeruje, że zmiany wydzielania hormonu mają istotne znaczenie w odniesieniu do metabolizmu. O tym będzie zapewne jeszcze mowa podczas dzisiejszego spotkania. Niektórzy autorzy sugerują, że GLP-1 prawdopodobnie nie są zaangażowane w poprawę cukrzycy po chirurgii bariatrycznej. Dyskusja trwa, ale najprawdopodobniej GLP-1 odgrywa jednak ważną rolę. Inne badania u osób nieotyłych wskazują poprawę kontroli glikemii ze znaczącym zwiększeniem aktywności leptyny bez zmian w osi trzustkowo-jelitowej. I wreszcie, żeby pokazać, jaki jest efekt remisji cukrzycy po różnych tych metodach operacyjnych, proszę zwrócić uwagę, że to przesuwanie żołądka 84%, ale prawie 50% nawet po opasce i po resekcji rękawowej również osiągamy dobre efekty. Wydaje się, że dysfunkcja dwunastnicy jest odpowiedzialna za patofizjologię cukrzycy. Jeżeli wyłączymy dwunastnicę, to być może, że leczymy jednocześnie cukrzycę. Także to jest bardzo złożony mechanizm, który w ciągu ostatnich 20 lat jest bardzo precyzyjnie właśnie badany. Także mechanizmy patofizjologiczne cukrzycy typu drugiego. Wiadomo, że zależna od otyłości, niewydolność komórek beta, wzrost aktywności adipocytokin, dysfunkcja inkretynowa. I wiemy o tym, że właśnie te operacje poprawiają sytuację poprzez między innymi wzrost stężenia GLP-1, hamowanie sekrecji glukagonu, czy wreszcie zwiększenie insulinowrażliwości. Resekcja rękawowa to jest bardzo ważne, bo po pierwsze zwiększa tę produkcję GLP-1, podobnie jak RUEN-Y Gastric Bypass, ale również redukuje wydzielanie greliny i pomaga zmniejszyć apetyt i masę ciała. I to od chorych często otrzymujemy taki komunikat, który mówi o tym właśnie, że mam zdecydowanie mniejszy apetyt, nie ten wilczy, który mnie po prostu powalał wieczorami, bo nie mogłem sobie z tym poradzić. Wiadomo, że te depozyty tłuszczu powodują obwodową i wątrobową insulinooporność. Wiemy też, że to działa jako właśnie zapalenie lipotoksyczne komórek beta. Ta wysoka skuteczność chirurgii bariatrycznej w kolejnych pracach jest pokazana. Mieliśmy również możliwość obserwacji i rozmowy z profesorem Schauerem, który był współautorem takiej pracy, właśnie kierownikiem tego projektu. Uzyskano u 5% pacjentów terapii medycznej poziom 6% hemoglobiny glikowanej, u prawie 40% po gastric bypass i 1/4 po sleeve gastrektomy. To są wyniki jego badań, o czym pani profesor, pani doktor Brzozowska jeszcze będzie mówić. Tu mieliśmy możliwość właśnie w Cleveland Clinic obejrzeć również możliwości leczenia bariatycznego z profesorem Rogulą między innymi. I w nawiązaniu do tych właśnie wytycznych chirurgicznych, również wytyczne Polskiego Towarzystwa Diabetologicznego 2020 mówią o tych wskazaniach do leczenia operacyjnego, o czym już mówiłem. Kwalifikacje do zabiegu z zakresu chirurgii metabolicznej rekomenduje się u każdego chorego z BMI powyżej 40 i cukrzycy typu drugiego. Natomiast u tych chorych poniżej 40, czyli między 35 a 40, przy tych szczególnych schorzeniach towarzyszących, o czym była mowa. Natomiast dla zabiegów z zakresu chirurgii metabolicznej u osób chorujących na cukrzycę kwalifikuje się pacjentów między 18 a 65 rokiem życia, no ale starszych chorych również można rozpatrzyć, jeżeli ich stan biologiczny jest, na to pozwala. I właściwie w jednym z czasopism już parę lat temu był taki rysuneczek, na którym mówi, jeżeli chirurgia jest najlepszym leczeniem cukrzycy, to dlaczego ty mi o tym nie powiedziałeś? To jest pacjent mówi do lekarza. Więc to jest bardzo zasadne i myślę, że teraz diabetolodzy są zobowiązani do tego, żeby powiedzieć o tym każdemu. Dziękuję za uwagę. Zmieściłem się w czasie.
Pięknie dziękujemy, panie profesorze, za tą imponującą prezentację. Proszę państwa, pragnę jeszcze powiedzieć, że czas na pytania, na komentarze będzie troszkę później, także poprosimy, jeżeli macie państwo takie pytania, o wstrzymanie się z nimi do czasu, kiedy będzie ogólna dyskusja, bo wiemy, że już w tej chwili nasi uczestnicy online przysyłają nam wiele pytań na czacie, ale postaramy się odpowiedzieć, nasi eksperci postarają się odpowiedzieć na nie w czasie dyskusji. Profesor Głuszek, thank you for your brilliant presentation with impressive video clips. Thank you very much. And we have already some questions on chat, but please be patient. We will try to answer them in the panel discussion later. Our next speaker is Dr. Małgorzata Brzozowska, who is the consultant endocrinologist at the Sutherland and St. George Hospitals in Sydney, the head of the endocrinology department at the Sutherland Hospital in Sydney, and a senior conjoint lecturer at the University of New South Wales, Sydney, Australia. Dr. Brzozowska is going to lecture, to present a lecture on indication, choice, and consequences of bariatric surgeries. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Małgorzata Brzozowska. Bardzo proszę, Pani Doktor.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for inviting me to your Congress. I feel honored to be here and I would like to thank Professor Głuszek for such an excellent overview of bariatric surgery, which I'm going to discuss in English now. However, there may be some overlap of topics as the Professor Głuszek's presentation was brilliant and very, very thorough and touched on several aspects of bariatric surgery. So, as we could see, obesity currently has a size of a worldwide epidemic, and the data which are cited here show that up to 1.9 billion of adult people are either overweight and 650 million are obese. And the country in which I currently live, which is Australia, approximately 2 in 3 people, or 63% of Australian adults, are either overweight or obese. Obesity, as already mentioned, does have several risks. As we could see on a graph below, this risk increases significantly once the BMI reaches the obesity size, which is BMI over 30. And people with a BMI over 30 have approximately 18-fold increased risk of type 2 diabetes, 2.5-fold increased risk of ischemic heart disease, approximately 1.75-fold increased risk of stroke, and as I have, as previously discussed, significantly increased risk of a mortality. Unfortunately, what has been already mentioned, medical treatments for obesity have 98% long-term failure rate. And we could discuss psychological aspects or lack of preparation. However, currently, there is more and more evidence for the very strong pathophysiological aspect of such resistance to the long-term weight loss. As we could see, even from this slide from my colleague, which was published in New England Journal in the year 2011, we can achieve in the short term significant weight loss. However, with time, just with a medical intervention, this weight does increase. And one of the hypotheses is that the body defends its fat mass set point, even if abnormally high. And it does it for several reasons. One of them could be, for example, to have a protection in the future to recover appropriately from acute illness. And as previously studied, such reaction of the body towards the weight loss is associated with several hormonal interactions which basically defend obesity. That's why very often the medical intervention, so-called lifestyle intervention, increased exercise, they simply don't work. So therefore, in Australia, the National Health and Research Council has already noted as early and in the year 2003 that surgical intervention combined with permanent lifestyle change is the most effective therapy for the weight reduction in terms of the extent and duration of the weight loss. The selection criteria for bariatric surgery have already been discussed. However, I'm going to discuss about them a bit more because they have been widened to acknowledge epidemics of obesity. So as we are all aware, people should have on average BMI of over 40 without comorbidities, or BMI between 35 and 40 with several medical comorbidities, have no endocrine cause of obesity, have obesity which has been present for over 5 years, and who have multiple failed non-surgical attempts to lose weight. These people should also not have a regular alcohol or drug use and do not have an uncontrolled psychiatric conditions, and they should understand that the surgery does involve regular follow-up and commitment to appointments. So I'm going to repeat some of the things which Professor Guszek has already mentioned. As you could see, these are the most commonly performed surgical procedures, with a sleeve gastrectomy being currently number one surgery, followed by the gastric bypass and gastric bending. However, what I'm going to say is, as a practicing endocrinologist in Australia, that the mechanism of a weight loss, which is being produced by this surgery, does vary, not only because of the caloric restriction, but because of the fact that these operations, such as sleeve gastrectomy, through the alteration of the anatomy, or gastric bypass surgery, do produce a very powerful hormonal reaction with the reduction in hormones such as ghrelin and increased production of the gut hormones such as PYY or GLP-1 hormones. And there are also interactions associated with various hormones such as adipokines and hepatokines involved. These are the, to show things in a proper perspective, I have cited the data of the American Society for Metabolic and Bariatric Surgery. As we could see, the numbers of bariatric surgery have been steadily increasing over the years. And gastric sleeve surgery, currently, it is a number one surgery due to its efficacy, not only towards the achieved weight loss, but also towards improvement in the diabetes control, followed by the gastric bypass, gastric band surgery, and there are less common surgeries as well. In Australia, only in the year 2015, there were approximately 23,000 procedures being performed, and in a place where I currently work, this place has been accredited as a center of excellence in bariatric surgery, and it does perform approximately 1,400 surgeries per year. However, they do happen only mainly within the private sector. So, which operation we should consider for our patients? I've just simplified that. As we could see, if the operation or intervention is more complicated, it becomes more effective in terms of producing of a weight loss, resolution of comorbidity. However, it does have increased surgical morbidity and mortality. The outcomes of bariatric surgery in terms of the resolution of metabolic abnormalities have been already recognized 20 years ago. And I'm again citing the study, meta-analysis, which was published in year 2004, which basically showed that the bariatric surgery leads to diabetes resolution in approximately 80%, improvement in sleep apnea, improvement in dyslipidemia, as well as improvement in hypertension. However, as we could see, the more complex procedure, it is more of an effective procedure. However, it would be associated with more of a mortality and morbidity. Bariatric surgery does its work through the fact that it allows for the sustained weight loss. And here I'm again citing the famous SOS study from year 2007. As we could see, lifestyle and medications are not very effective at all. Gastric banding does have some effect. However, the more invasive procedures such as gastric sleeve surgery allows for the significant loss of the body weight, and what's more important, for the long-term maintenance of this lost weight. Bariatric, and these data have been recently replicated and again showed how effective these procedures are, and also that they do result in significant improvement of type 2 diabetes. This slide simply summarizes a meta-analysis of 33 data sets and over the period of 10 years. And again, it is very much in favor of these procedures, showing that the more advanced procedures lead to the long-term weight loss with the improvement in comorbidities. And this happens through the mechanism of energy restrictions with altered hormonal, neural, and nutrient signaling. This slide summarizes what has already been mentioned, a very, very important aspect of this bariatric surgery, as these procedures, on average, result in 24% reduction in overall mortality in comparison with the control group. And the most common causes of death, as discussed by Professor Guszek, were either ischemic heart disease or presence of a neoplastic disease. So, this was an introduction and some overlap with Professor Stock. However, now I'm going to discuss and focus more on an aspect which relates more to the resolution of type 2 diabetes. So there have been overwhelming, very, very positive reports in the press saying that bariatric surgery, it is the best therapy for diabetes which we have today, and it has been shown that it is of a very low risk. The question is, will type 2 diabetes alone be an indication for surgery? However, there has been some skeptical questions about how effective it is, also for what spectrum of patients, over what period of time, and at what cost. And not all those questions have been answered as yet. So, we have already discussed the indications for bariatric surgery. However, I just would like to point to this part of the graph, which shows that currently, because of its efficacy in terms of the resolution of type 2 diabetes, people who are classified as having type 1 diabetes with a BMI between 30 to 35, who have failed optimal lifestyle and medical treatment, can be classified and considered as having metabolic surgery. And this statement has been endorsed by the American Diabetes Association in year 2016. So basically, to summarize it, that this option of a surgical treatment is being proposed to patients at the earliest stages of their obesity because it is supposed to help them to recover from incurable metabolic condition. This particular work from United States, from Cleveland Clinic, which was published in year 2017, which looked at the primary outcome of so-called remission from type 2 diabetes with HbA1c of less than 6%, with or without diabetes medication, did show the superiority of the bariatric surgery. In this particular work, there were 150 patients who were included with advanced diabetes, as shown by the HbA1c of 9.2%, and with advanced obesity with an average BMI of 37. And as we could see, bariatric surgery intervention did lead to much more significant weight loss, with a gastric bypass being more powerful tool than gastric sleeve surgery, and certainly much more superior just to the dietary intervention. But most importantly, it did lead to the remission of type 2 diabetes in nearly 30% of patients versus 5% of patients who were treated with a dietary intervention. And as we could see, in a gastric bypass group, majority of these patients managed to be treated and cured without use of any medications. And again, multiple studies have shown that the more invasive surgery, such as gastric bypass surgery, is much more efficacious than gastric banding surgery. However, I did include this slide because I wanted to point out to you that this is not as simple, that people who manage to have a remission from diabetes are usually people who are of a younger age, who have had a shorter duration of diabetes, who have been using less of the diabetes medications, and who had lower insulin use at baseline. And there has been also some improvement in reduced dyslipidemia and hypertension. So there is already a question that this particular surgery may not be a panacea for everyone. It may actually be more efficacious for people who have less advanced disease. So the question remains, how do the people achieve such an excellent result? What is the mechanism behind the recovery from diabetes? Is it just a restriction of the calories which lead to the weight loss? Or is there a mechanism which involves several hormonal interactions? And the most important cited here is ghrelin, which is a hormone which drives the appetite, or hormones which are produced by the L cells of the small intestines, such as GLP-1 hormone or PYY hormone. As we could see on this slide, the gastric bypass surgery does induce several psychological changes, physiological changes. It does lead to the very powerful hormonal reactions, also does improve glucose homeostasis with the increased insulin sensitivity and beta cell function, also has some effect on the bile acid and microbiology of the gut, which is more and more being explored, leads to reduction in hunger and increase in energy expenditure, and even does change the taste of the food which is being eaten. So, more and more data point towards the gut-brain axis, which is a major component of appetite regulation and which is being altered following bariatric surgery. So for the purpose of this talk, I'm just going to focus on the hormones for which we have a strong evidence that their concentration is being changed after these procedures, such as ghrelin, GLP-1 hormone, and a hormone in which I have a special interest in terms of the bone, but also glucose homeostasis, which is a peptide PYY. The ghrelin, it is a hormone which is being produced by the gastric antrum and fundus. It is released preprandially and is rapidly suppressed by the food intake. And there is increase of ghrelin with fasting, hunger, anorexia, and weight loss. And that this hormone doesn't really, the concentration of this hormone doesn't really change after gastric band surgery. However, there is some evidence that there is a reduction in the level of this hormone after gastric sleeve and gastric bypass surgery. And so this could be one of the explanations why, for example, gastric sleeve surgery, in which part of the stomach from which ghrelin is being produced is being removed, why it does lead to the significant weight loss, which is comparable to gastric bypass surgery. Then there is a GLP-1 hormone, which is being released in response to ingested nutrients. And as Professor Gushek has already mentioned, this particular hormone leads to the satiety, which leads to the early meal termination. And it does have a very important aspect in terms of regulation of glucose, with the stimulation of glucose-dependent insulin secretion, slowing of the gastric emptying, and inhibition of glucagon secretion. There is a lot of literature which tries to explain the benefits of bariatric surgery through the increased production of this hormone. However, there is also some literature which does contradict it. And finally, the pancreatic polypeptide tyrosine hormone, PYY hormone, which is again produced by the lower intestinal endocrine L cells, which promotes nutrient absorption, satiety, and promotes insulin action. And currently, more and more data does point to this particular hormone as being of a crucial role in restoration of the impaired glucose-mediated insulin and glucagon secretion in gastric bypass subjects. And I have just presented an abstract at the Italian European Congress of Endocrinology, which does have such data. Just briefly to mention that bariatric surgery also is very helpful in terms of resolution of fatty liver in obese patients, and this has been already confirmed by excellent work which did show results of a liver biopsy of patients who undergone this surgery. Now, so this was all enthusiastic, positive talk about these procedures. However, I also, as a medical practitioner, would like to point out about possible complications which are being associated with these procedures. I mean, there are surgical complications which we have discussed. With the gastric bending surgery, in my opinion, one of the most serious complications is the fact that there is inadequate weight loss. So this operation is not very efficacious. And because of that, there are data which point up to 50% increase need for this surgery after 10 years. That's why the gastric sleeve has currently become number one
surgery in the United States and worldwide, which is associated with leak and bleeds and gastric reflux. However, it is much more efficient. And gastric bypass surgery, which is the best operation for the complex diabetes. However, this particular surgery may also lead to the metabolic or hormonal abnormalities with the side effects, which my team, my research team in Sydney, has been currently investigating. So, as we are all aware from the previous talk, bariatric surgery may lead to the nutritional deficiencies. And these deficiencies include protein, as well as micro and macro minerals, and they occur on average in 30 to 70% of bariatric patients. And very importantly, for example, in terms of a bone aspect, it is often very tricky for the patient to be supplemented adequately with, for example, vitamin D, because, for example, of problems with absorption or other pathophysiology which is associated with this process. So currently, there are also lack of the proper standardized guidelines for nutritional care of patients who undergo bariatric surgery. There are various protocols, but there are no protocols which are being uniformly accepted in all countries. So, because of this, and also because possibly of some hormonal interactions, bariatric surgery may also lead to some other problems, and which is, for example, increase of a bone loss and fractures. There haven't been that many studies which looked at this aspect of bariatric surgery, and this part of the surgery has been complicated. And this part of the surgery has been complicated by only few studies with small sample sizes, inconsistent study measures, and inconsistent degrees of bone loss. So the risk factors for the post-surgical bone loss include, as already mentioned, surgically induced nutritional deficiencies with malabsorption of calcium and vitamin D. There is also increase in bone turnover and reduction in the bone mineral density due to the changes in the mechanical loading of the skeleton. There is association with a secondary hyperparathyroidism, problem with the pre-existing and exacerbated by the surgery, vitamin D deficiency, energy restriction, with increase in the cortisol level and decrease in the calcium absorption, and also the fact which we have described in the first worldwide review, altered gut and neural peptide signaling, including the changes in the adipokines and hepatokines as well. So the pragmatic aspect of such complication, which is a bone loss which continues after bariatric surgery, has been published already several years ago. And the study which collected data over 24 months did show that bariatric surgery may result in a bone loss in a spine as well as in hip. And this has been confirmed both by the measurement of a BMD DEXA scan as well as measurement in a QCT. The study which we have published in 2 years ago actually does show that the bone loss is not just caused by the mechanical unloading. The bone loss can be also experienced in places which are not so much associated with weight loss, such as radius and lumbar spine. And this raises the questions, are the changes in the hormones which are being produced by the bariatric surgery, which are so beneficial in terms of the resolution of type 2 diabetes, are they also responsible for such side effects of bariatric surgery? So finally, there are data which show that bariatric surgery is associated with increased risk of fractures, on average with 2.3-fold increased relative risk of fractures. Majority of these fractures happen in hand, leg, and foot. and 50% of fractures occur after 5 years post bariatric surgery. So this is not an immediate complication. And furthermore, that has been highlighted that operations such as gastric bypass surgery are much more likely to result in a risk of fractures in comparison with a gastric banding surgery. Finally, I would like to touch on some interesting aspects of bariatric surgery, which may lead to some psychological or even psychiatric problems. It has been already noted in the recent data that people who have undergone bariatric surgery, especially more complex types of bariatric surgery, may be at increased risk of increased alcohol use. And interestingly, 50% of his excess of alcohol use were a new onset, which did occur after the bariatric surgery. There has been also noted there new persistent opioid use following surgery in up to 10% of patients, including also increased risk of marijuana. Bariatric surgery somehow had an impact on impulsive, compulsive buying, spending, self-harm tendencies, and also people who undergone bariatric surgery in some studies were more likely to change their marital status, including increased risk of a divorce. So these are quite interesting aspects of these operations. Therefore, I would like to summarize my talk. Bariatric surgery, indeed, we have shown that it is the most effective weight loss intervention for severely obese patients. And it is the only intervention which can lead to the long-term weight loss. It does decrease long-term morbidity, such as diabetes, it does decrease mortality, and does decrease healthcare use. The normal glycemia after gastric bypass and gastric sleeve occasionally can be achieved even within days before weight loss, and this may point out towards the powerful hormonal interactions. Changes in postprandial levels of the gut hormones, such as GLP-1, peptide YY, and ghrelin, are maybe the most important glucoregulatory mechanism. However, there is a need for monitoring of the bone health post-bariatric surgery. And we should also assess addiction, self-harm, and relationship discordance prior to bariatric surgery. Therefore, long-term safety and risks, with special consideration to skeletal health, need further evaluation. Thank you.
Dr. Brzozowska, thank you very much for your outstanding presentation. Our next speaker is Dr. Michał Marzec from the Department of Biomedical Sciences, University of Copenhagen, Denmark. He's an experienced researcher in the molecular pathways of diabetes and also a visiting professor in our university. He's going to talk about pathogenetic implications of proinsulin mishandling. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Michał Marzec.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me and giving me a chance to talk about. I will look here maybe at you, at my laboratory work. We'll take a break from the bariatric surgery. That's going to be very much about basic science. So not that much bad, more of a bench. So. I wanted to start very generally. Some of you probably know very well there are at least two types of diabetes. Of course, there is more of them. They can be divided or subdivided. They are monogenic diabetes. But the most popular is type 1 and type 2. And clearly, the type 1 is the one that we treat as an autoimmune disease, where our immunological system destroys beta cells, or there is not enough of them, and therefore we do not have enough of insulin or not at all insulin in circulation. Type 2 is a different animal. It has been for long believed that basically the cells on the periphery are in a muscle or in the liver, they do not respond to insulin. We actually have for majority, for the biggest part of a period of type 2 diabetes, we actually have a lot of insulin in circulation. So that basically translates to this slide, but basically on your left shows the traditional model, how it has been believed diabetes, at least type 2 diabetes, is happening. So basically there is in the beginning, out of nowhere, insulin resistance shows up, okay? And beta cells try to, so insulin resistance in a sense that insulin cannot induce cells to take in glucose and lower the circulating level and use the energy from that. And therefore, beta cells are forced to produce more insulin and more insulin. And that leads to hyperinsulinemia, so the second one, and then to beta cell exhaustion because they cannot produce more and they die and we have type 2 diabetes. So that's a classical model that maybe you could think is not completely wrong, because this one on the right-hand side, the new model, uses basically the same building blocks, but in a different order. So basically, it calls for different causality for the type 2 diabetes and maybe also for type 1 diabetes. And that starts with beta cells having their own defect at the beginning. They start to produce more of an insulin, which actually the recent publications show is not that much of an insulin per se, it is a pro-insulin, so a pro-hormone from an insulin, and that induces maybe not in all cases insulin resistance, the peripheral insulin resistance, and the rest is the same story, okay? Okay, so about type 2 diabetes, and I think I see that things disappeared. So you will, and they disappeared from here too. Let's see how much of that disappears. The idea here was, of the left upper slide, is that 85, let's start with the other one. I don't want to mix it up. But the obese and insulin resistance. Okay, so there is, if we take a group of people, 70% that are obese to a different degree and that also have present insulin resistance, whichever way it is measured, okay, they do not have type 2 diabetes. They may be on the way to develop it, but they themselves do not have it. Let's see. Well, it's fine. We can survive without that. Okay, so basically the point was here that insulin resistance per se does not equal type 2 diabetes. Okay, in majority cases, it does not at all develop to type 2 diabetes. It is not a prerequisite to have type 2 diabetes. There is something else going on in many of us, or in many of those patients. So currently, the new model is heavily discussed. This is actually not a new idea. This is an idea that has been proposed more than 30 years ago and then forgotten. There was no data about human samples. There was not enough of data from healthy individuals before they developed type 2 diabetes. The data was basically around surrounding type 2 diabetes is based on people that already do have diabetes. Okay, so the snapshot of this pathophysiology is within the people that are already sick. Now, there is more and more publication telling us that actually it is not insulin resistance, it is not obesity per se, it is a beta cell that is dysfunctional. Okay, so this is not to say that one and another are not connected, they are not, there is no interplay within, with them, but we know that they are people who are at least by look healthy, okay, slim, and they can have type 2 diabetes, and we know that there is a big group of the population that is obese and never develops type 2 diabetes. Okay, so there is something else going on there, and there is a discussion if this is an early beta cell defect, so if there is something wrong with beta cells themselves, or is it related, for example, to our diet, a lack of activity, and certain beta cells in certain individuals secreting more insulin that then leads to insulin resistance and development of type 2 diabetes. It is unclear how it goes. This is an example from, I think, last year or 2 years ago of those two people publishing a discussion about it. Who comes first? What is a chicken? What is an egg? Is it a beta cell that is bad? Or is it an environment that is inducing the beta cells to secrete more insulin? They, however, do not discuss insulin resistance or obesity from a perspective of an inducer of that. That is not entirely right, because I think in the late 50s in the United States, officially 1% of people was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes. I need to keep it close. Currently, we are over 10 or 13%. So that clearly is not genetics. Okay, people did not evolve that fast. McDonald's evolved, our food evolved, and obesity appears. So there is clearly a connection and correlation, but it's definitely in many cases in type 2 diabetes does not start with obesity. Okay, so I will see how far I get, because I may have too many slides. But I will go about type 2 diabetes, and if I still have 2 minutes, I will show you type 1 diabetes, what we work on. So up front, I don't know what triggers type 2 diabetes. Okay, I don't also know what triggers loss of peripheral immune tolerance, but I will show you what we how we were thinking about it. So this is an example of, in this case, though it actually doesn't matter too much, about what is going on in beta cell, in pancreatic beta cells in type 1 diabetes or in a pre-type 1 diabetes, okay? It is complicated, it's difficult to understand. You can publish papers on any of that aspect. So when we first thought about how can we contribute, we thought, what is central here? Okay, so central is a beta cell, and central is insulin. If you don't have those two, and you can imagine a healthy organism, you will not have diabetes, okay? Or probably you will not have a diabetes. Maybe you could have some form of it. So we thought, okay, with all this mix here, the insulin or prohormone proinsulin is the most important thing that is then that leads to, or can lead, or participates in the diabetes development. So basically we look at the insulin synthesis or biosynthesis, and you may or may not know that. Insulin is produced as a pre-prohormone that is then enzymatically processed to a proinsulin. That's the part that we work on. How the proinsulin is folded. Then the proinsulin is basically a long chain like a spaghetti of amino acids, but to perform its hormonal function, it needs to be folded to a 3D structure. And only then it can interact with a receptor or receptors and transmit the signal. And that has to happen in a beta cell. So how does that happen? How does that happen is an ongoing research in general, okay? But you would think that we would already know a lot about it. So we know that there are certain chemical reactions happening to keep it in a certain 3D shape. We know that proinsulin in beta cells will dimerize, and then later on when it matures, it will form hexamers and so on until there is a crystal of a mature insulin that is secreted to the circulation, okay? So what we work on is how the proinsulin is actually folded, how from an amino acid it becomes a functional molecule. Okay, so I've shown that slide the last time I had a brief presentation here. When we started it, we basically thought that everything is known and that pretty much, that's how it looks. When you type in a PubMed, a proinsulin, you get 200,000 scientific articles, okay? Even more when you use insulin and diabetes. So if you are any sane person trying to start a career in research, that's a no-go, okay? That means that everything has been done there. And more, and more, and more. Insulin and proinsulin are the most studied proteins in humans. But then when you look what is known about how it is folded, so folding is this process of making this 3D shape, okay? Then you see that there is less than 1,000 articles about it, and actually there is less than 100. It's only the special AI using word search that recently started to show 700 articles, okay? There's literally 5 or 7 groups in the world that are doing it, which is extremely surprising. If you think how prevalent is type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, what are the consequences for the society, how much does it cost, and so on and so on. And also, how many articles already are there that are mentioning proinsulin? But then you don't know how it is built, okay? How it is made. So that was striking to us. And you can summarize, of course, this is a little bit of an exaggeration, but if you want to summarize what is happening during the maturation of insulin, that's what happens. Nothing. They are disulfide bonds that are formed on any protein that is secreted from cells, okay? Because there is a reducing and oxidizing environment that has to, so those disulfide bonds are keeping it closed for any other protein. It's not specific for proinsulin. There are other proteins in the part of a cell called endoplasmic reticulum that are known to do different things to insulin or to proinsulin. They process it, they help it dimerize maybe, and definitely a lot about degradation because it's a therapeutic target. If you can stop degradation of proinsulin, then maybe you can push beta cells to secrete even more and more and then, so to speak, deal with diabetes that way. But in a positive way, what is happening to molecule, that's basically what is there for the last 30 years, more or less. Of course, I'm not citing all the competitors. But anyway, when we started it, we actually started with the PubMed search based on those two pictures. This is like a graphical representation trying to more or less show how pro-IGF looks and pro-insulin. Pro-IGF is an insulin-like growth factor, okay? It is evolutionary very closely related to insulin. It looks the same, okay? It's very, very similar, okay? And the place that I worked on shown at that time, more than whatever it is, 10, 12 years ago, that insulin-like growth factor is folded by a protein called, in short, GRP, glucose-regulated protein 94. So all that is happening in endoplasmic reticulum in the beta cells, okay? And that's the place where all hormones are produced. This is endoplasmic reticulum. This is not cytoplasm. You have to be sitting in that subcellular compartment. So when you look at those two pictures, it's basically you automatically, if you are interested at all in it, you will ask the question, is the same molecule involved in folding of the proinsulin? Okay? And then you search the literature and you find nothing, not only on that molecule, but on any other molecule that is folding proinsulin. So basically that's where we started. And now I will try to go quick. So we did the modeling, so the crystal structure of GRP94 is known, proinsulin structure, not so much. This is actually a mutated proinsulin. Believe it or not, human proinsulin has not been officially crystallized and published, so pharmaceutical companies probably know it, but not we. So this is a mutant, but it's good enough to do the modeling. And it says nothing except that they too can bind. Okay, and they bind in a way that is similar for other substrates of GRP94. So the result of that is we can assume that proinsulin is folded by that molecule that we think. We also confirm that they can co-precipitate, so they touch each other in endoplasmic reticulum. Okay, and then we did what everyone else is doing using CRISPR. We took out the GRP94 out of beta cells, or actually model beta cells, and took out, by this I mean we genetically removed the expression of that protein, so it is no longer expressed, as you can see there. This is a Western blot, there will be few of them. Western blot is basically beta cells or any cells lysed and protein content analyzed by specific antibodies. So we can see that those cells, when we knock out, take out GRP94, they also lose proinsulin internally. There is not much of an added phenotype, which is very surprising. It's very specific. Okay, and on the bottom there is immunostaining showing the same thing. Okay, we have also shown that if we don't have GRP94, proinsulin is misprocessed. It has different conversion intermediates. So basically, it's very technical, but the point here is that to get from proinsulin to insulin, you have to go through a few different steps to get there, and those steps can differ if you don't make them the right way, like jumping one step or four steps or whatever there is. And the result here on the bottom is electron microscopy showing you on the left a darker spot. Those are secretory granules in beta cells. When mature insulin is crystallized in electron microscopy, it's dense and dark. But when the insulin cannot crystallize, they are more amorphic, bigger and gray. And that's why you almost don't see it there, okay? So basically there is another part of this phenotype, the GRP94 knockout cells or cells, beta cells where GRP94 activity is inhibited, they also secrete less of the proinsulin. So basically this does not explain, is that all? Okay, and there is a less, whatever those cells also secrete as an insulin and proinsulin is less active. So basically, this does not explain really how proinsulin is folded or misfolded when we take out that protein, but at least it shows that the protein is important, that it's critical for the normal maturation of the proinsulin. So we are still investigating how it is specifically happening, but once you succeed with one thing, you want to ask the question, is there something else there? And there is an easy, fairly easy way to do it. We exogenously expressed proinsulin and GRP94 in beta cells, precipitated it, and then send it for the mass spectrometry to identify anything that is binding to those two proteins. And then using Microsoft Excel or reading or a finger or some bioinformatics, we pre-selected proteins that will localize to the endoplasmic reticulum, so the place where the proinsulin is folded. Nothing else is interesting or is random or is trash. And that protein has to bind to GRP94 and proinsulin, so kind of like forming a complex. It doesn't have to be that way, we just selected it that way. Okay. And there were a few proteins that are known to participate in folding of proinsulin or degrading it. And one of them that was unknown is this red one, FKBP2. Okay. We didn't know what it does. We just confirmed that it can actually precipitate. And then we use Google to learn what the protein does. And protein, this enzyme was doing something strange. It was isomerizing proline. Nothing that we understood at that point at all. So we went to Google, because I'm not a biochemist. I don't understand amino acids, how they work. So apparently proline is the only amino acid that we have in our proteins that can change its shape. So if you imagine your spaghetti, you could bend it or break it. Maybe bend it, not break it. But you can change the direction of your spaghetti, of your amino acid chain, by a few degrees. Okay? And so it happens that human proinsulin has only one evolutionary conserved proline. It has two more in C-peptide, but there is only one that sits wherever the arrow shows. It doesn't matter really where it is. So basically, we hypothesized. Okay, so I should step back, not to lose you, or not to lose you completely. When the protein is made, okay, it's made from amino acids, and they are all the same except of proline. Proline can be, let's say, in isomerized as cis or trans, because that's how it is randomly in the environment. There's no preference. when you produce amino acid, you can use both prolines, and therefore half of the proinsulin produced in the beginning will have a trans, which is good, and then cis, which is not good. And therefore there is a need, most probably, for an enzyme that will switch from cis to trans and then allow proinsulin to mature normally. Okay, that's the hypothesis. So we modeled those two proteins and did exactly the same thing. We took out FKBP2 and we observed the same phenotype. We started to lose proinsulin in the cells. So there is a functional relationship between those two. In opposition to the previous phenotype, we showed that there is a higher secretion, which is also more or less similar to the one of the beginning slides when I show you that in the pre-diabetic period there is a hyperinsulinemia or hyperproinsulinemia. So this is a phenotype that agrees with that. There is higher secretion. And there is less of the folding. This is another Western blot of another experiment when you can separate proteins depending on their weight during the size exclusion chromatography. And so what is on the right-hand side, this darker side, shows basically there is more proinsulin that is heavily misfolded. Okay, so basically that was quick. Oh, there's more. And so we also showed, we also wanted to show directly that there is an isomerization. Okay, so we used ion mobility and then liquid chromatography with mass spectrometry, all so complicated I completely do not know how to do it. I only delivered samples. And the machine basically says that, yes, there are two different isomers in the human body. So basically proving what had to be proven, because there is no other way to have it. So basically now it looks like when we produce proinsulin, we can produce 50% in a trans conformation that can normally fold and produce insulin. And then there is another part that has a cis conformation that requires an enzymatic reaction to become normal. If not, it is misfolded and degraded. So obviously, then the question is, what is happening to that enzyme FKBP2 in diabetes? Do people have more or less for that? And soon enough, you will be able to read about it. I will not tell now. Okay, so now we added FKBP2, GRP94, and you are already dying, so I will not do the last one, because we also don't know that one. But there is a chance that there is more into it. Okay, do we have 5 minutes? No? Yes? Should I go away? Yes? Okay, 5 minutes. Okay, so type 1 diabetes. So so I will use the same approach and use the same... So how this would apply to type 1 diabetes? It's an idea. It's not proven. Okay? It's easy to say we are misfolding proinsulin, there's no proinsulin, beta cell die, and poof, we have diabetes. Okay? It's not that easy for type 1 diabetes because you officially start from an autoimmune disease. Type 1 diabetes officially... I'm not saying it's not true. Okay? I'm saying only maybe trying to say that maybe it's not a full true. That type 1 diabetes is autoimmune disease. The beta cells have nothing to do. They are just poor victims. Okay. So we don't see anything here, so why would I say? my point was here that regarding autoimmune, part of it is that we know that they are HLA risk genes, okay, that predispose us to type 1 diabetes. So basically those two pictures here are basically to show that half of people with type 1 diabetes don't have those genes, and then half of the population that is healthy actually do have those genes that are predisposing for type 1 diabetes. What does that mean? That there has to be something else. It's not just how tall or short you are, then you go left or right. There has to be an additional environmental factor. And we know that it exists because there is an increase in type 1 diabetes in multiple population. And that clearly has to be linked to environmental factors or obesity, eating, or something else, not genetics. And on top of that, recently it has been again resurfaced the idea that beta cells themselves can express HLA2. What does that mean? That means that they can present antigens themselves. And they can become target, and by themselves alone, they can activate immune system. Okay, they express HLA1 and 2. That's it. It's enough already to, not completely, but let's say that's it. You can start autoimmune reaction by yourself. Okay, quick. This one you have seen. So when we take out GRP94 as an example, proinsulin disappears. Now the question is, where does it go? Okay. And that is an important question, not only for me to now show off. But basically, one of the things that is that has to happen to a protein, any protein in a cell, is that it is going to be degraded. It can go through the liposomes, endosomes, crinophagy. There is many different names for that. And then there are proteasomes that are most standard way of dealing with the old proteins or misfolded proteins. Okay, in beta cells, it has been for long believed in the normal beta cells, unstimulated, there is only a standard proteasome, and that's it. Nothing interesting, forget about it. There, however, exist in general few other types of proteasomes that are linked to inducing immune diseases. Okay, and they are called intermediate proteasome, immunoproteasome. What they actually have different is the specific enzymatic subunit in them. And those subunit cuts the spaghetti in a different way. When you cut it in a different way and present it on your surface, on this HLA genes or MHA, depending how you want to call them, then you can induce autoimmune system to attack you. So it is important what is that small subunit in the proteasome, because it may send you for the autoimmunity or not. Okay? Very quickly, so yes, that's what I described. So we actually look at the model beta cells. I don't know if you can see it, or I need to click. Okay, here. And we show that one of the inducible subunits of the proteasome is actually expressed in beta cells, where it should not be without any stimulation. All right? It is expressed even more when you misfold protein. And that's very critical for type 1 diabetes, because it's enough now to have the viral infection, or eat too much, or do not exercise. And type 1 has the ability to be shifted towards type 2. Okay, there is an environmental factor that you can imagine that can induce that disease. Okay, and Marie did that time mass spec, and also showed that this subunit is actually part of an active proteasome, not just wandering around in the cell. Okay, so there is a functionality of it. And when you knock it out, so take out this subunit, you can restore or upregulate the proinsulin levels in cells, which means basically they are targeted by that subunit to be destroyed, to be degraded. Okay? Very quickly. And here, we took our cells without GRP94, with this expressed different proteasome, and we asked the question, if we look at the peptides presented on the surface to the immune system, do those peptides differ between the normal cells and the cells without GRP94? Or without functional GRP94? And it's hard to see here, but this red thing shows peptides that are specific only for the cells that do not have GRP94, which basically means they have a different peptides presented. So when the lymphocytes come for the surveillance, it sees de facto a different cell. So what it should do, it should kill it. And that's the definition of autoimmunity in general. Okay, and this doesn't matter. Basically to show that a cell can express 500 peptides. And if you modulate that cells, they are expressing different types of those groups. And here it is shown that interferon gamma, the one on the left-hand side, a typical example of induced immunity for the beta cells, has an overlap with GRP94, which is more typical for type 2 diabetes when there is proinsulin misfolding. So there is overlap between those two diseases. So the point here is that there is something common and something specific. Okay, interleukin 1b can be related closer to type 2 diabetes, but it's also present in type 1 diabetes. The point is here that there is an overlap, and maybe there is a contribution of a basic mechanism to both diseases. Okay, a lot, I know. Oh. We can forget that. Thank you.
Dr. Marzec, thank you very much for your amazing speech. Ja zastanawiam się tylko, jak długo trzeba pracować nad takim tematem, aby o rzeczach tak trudnych mówić tak swobodnie. Dziękujemy, panie doktorze. And our next speaker is Professor Leszek Czupryniak, Head of the Diabetology and Internal Medicine Department in Medical University in Warsaw, Polish Diabetology Association Board Representative for International Cooperation, and the Editor-in-Chief of Current Topics in Diabetes. He is going to convince us that diabetology has become the most exciting part of the medicine. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Leszek Czupryniak. Panie profesorze, zapraszam.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction. Thank you very much for inviting me here. I'm the one who hasn't traveled from other country or from other continent. It just took me 2 hours to come here from Warsaw. So it was actually the easiest thing for me out of all speakers to come here. I'm delighted and feel privileged to be invited to Kielce, and I'm not just saying it out of courtesy. Kielce is a very important place on the map of Polish diabetology. Exactly 6 years ago and 1 month, yes, Grażyna, we had one of the best of our annual meetings here in the place where the expo is located in Kielce. I'm saying Grażyna because Dr. Grażyna Majerwiczak was the chair of the local organizing committee, and we were the only ones who at the very beginning believed it's possible, because usually large meetings, it's 2,500 people. We organize them in places like Warsaw, Krakow, Poznań, Gdańsk, and why Kielce? And it was one of the most successful meetings in an excellent venue, and of course the city is also beautiful, and it was new for many diabetologists who came here. So as I said, I feel privileged to be invited here. I guess you needed some local component, and that's why I'm here. The title of my talk is not so much scientific, and I will be talking on the clinical side of diabetes. Diabetes is in the title of this conference, and I'm also delighted that you acknowledge diabetes as a problem, medical problem worth presenting in this way. And it's true, as I was introduced, I'm a diabetologist. I'm the head of internal diabetes and internal medicine department in Warsaw. I work in this hospital here. Somewhere here is my room, I guess, or maybe here. Yes, it's here or here. Easy to find, on the third floor. And it's in the second building. The big one is for surgical department. Surgeons always goes first. Always in this meeting you heard a lot about surgery. And I will be contradicting these conclusions in a way, being a bit provocative, but also having strong evidence to support that bariatric surgery, as fascinated as it is, and I'm the one who has been fascinated with the results for the last 25 years, its role will be changing. And if you think that medicine develops very fast, if you compare the contents of the two first lectures and my lecture, you will see that it's really developing fast, because I hope I will change your mind on bariatric surgery within a couple of hours. So the second building is for internal medicine departments, and as I said, I'm on the third floor here. I've been the president of Diabetes Poland, our scientific association, and as I love talking about diabetes, that's one of the reasons I'm here, I guess. So you've already seen this picture, and we haven't coordinated this in Professor Głuszek's speech. I guess if you look for a nice, maybe not nice, but true and reliable and credible picture of diabetes, these four horsemen of the diabetes apocalypse are really here. And I don't know why they're only men, but men has usually bigger bellies than women. And I would bet you would think that all these four horsemen have diabetes. In fact, only two of them have, and the other two don't. And that nicely composes with the previous lecture, where it's not that simple. Whenever an obese person comes to our office, we think, oh gosh, that's another super obese person who, of course, doesn't eat anything. There's a clear relationship. The more obese you are, the less you eat. If you ask a patient, people who are extremely obese do not eat anything at all. So it's difficult to fight obesity, because you can't tell them, eat less. They say, I don't eat anything already. I can't eat, I would die. And that's a challenge. From a practical point of view, if you want to confronted, ask them to fill in a dietary diary. So ask them to write what they eat every day in the evening. Please sit down and write down, not jot down what you have eaten, because you do not eat anything or very little, it will be easy to write, not much work to do. And then after a week or two of such a diary, you will be able to realize that it's actually opposite. These people simply do not know how much they eat. And the roads leading to obesity are extremely complicated. Obesity is in the brain, not in these bellies here. In fact, I don't have scans of these diaries, but I would show you. I could show you those diaries when people, one of the most recent patient who doesn't eat, a lady who doesn't eat anything, when I calculated the number of sandwiches she has recorded for one day, it was like 12 or 13 sandwiches, so it's almost a loaf of bread. And I just said, well, it's great that you do not eat anything, because I would be terrified if you really eat something. Then I know, 5 loaves of bread, just one is fine. I'm just saying it just to cheer you up a little bit, because they usually put me at the end of the session to just wake up the audience. I'm not saying your lecture was boring, but mine is a little bit more lively anyway. So, but that's the job I'm doing here. So sorry. And it is really a very complicated, one of the probably biggest challenges we are facing in modern medicine, because obesity is the mother of many diseases. Fighting it is a daunting task, and diabetes, and of course I am biased here, I would say is one of the most serious complications of obesity. The challenge here is because eating is pleasant. This is the member of my family of whom I have full consent to present this picture. It's the husband of my sister. I have older sister, and it's her husband, and he's a vascular surgeon. He has type 2 diabetes, and I was just looking for a picture which would present how pleasant eating could be, and just I went through all internet and I couldn't find a better picture than the one I took myself. I'm saying he's a vascular surgeon because he's been for 30 or 40 years of his medical career, he's been looking after the patients with diabetic foot syndrome. So he's excellently aware of what diabetes may lead to. He amputated a number of legs, of course, as well. Still, I've never seen him happier than here. It's the birthday dinner of my daughter, one of my daughters, but that's not an excuse. He's just happy he's eating. But if you think I must be an awful person that I'm having a laugh at the expense of my family member, this is the picture of myself. And I'm also pretty happy here over a nice piece of meat. And I'm a bloody diabetologist. I know very well what it means if you eat too much and do not exercise enough, and if you develop overweight. And still, I love eating, of course. And eating is over advertised, it's overappreciated, but still we love it. And if we made a survey here, as we are sitting here, and if I asked you, okay, what position, how would you rank eating in the list of your pleasures? Most of you are young here, so I think it would be the first, but it would definitely be in the first 10 pleasures or maybe even fives. As it happens, when we get older, it moves up on this ranking, and people, not yet my age, but the age of my brother-in-law, food is number one, and sometimes it's just the only pleasure people have. So when we talk about lifestyle modifications in type 2 diabetes patients over 60 or 70, you can just give up talking about changing their dietary pattern. It will simply not work. We have to address the treatment to the way people eat. But still, I didn't even start answering the question in the title of my talk. But I want to start to show you what are the areas of diabetes care. So one is behavior, food behavior, everyday life, socializing, food is for socializing, food is pleasure, food is, if you switch on television, you will see number of programs where celebrate chefs will be preparing meals. It's interesting, it's mouth-watering, you cannot really stop watching it, and then you rush to the kitchen and you eat any food you actually find there. And we usually do it in the evening. Imagine if it, one of my theories, everything's fine, yeah, that's on purpose, yeah. That's, I just want them to look at me, you see, at me, and listen to me. It just slides, something will come up here in a moment. I'm just making one of multiple digressions in my talk. Imagine, no problem, I appreciate your care, thank you very much. Imagine the food would be culturally treated as bowel movements, as going to a toilet. Imagine if you look really, really objectively at anyone who's eating, eating is a horrible thing to watch. There is a golden rule of any photographer, never take pictures of people who sleep or who are eating, because they usually look awful. We open our mouth, there's the food we are trying to bite, and there's something sometimes dropping from our mouth. It's not very nice. And imagine if it was told, okay, if you want to defecate, go to the toilet. If you want to eat, go to another toilet where you just lock yourself in a cubicle, just eat there, and then go and see other people. That would solve the problem, but still somehow this food is bloody so pleasant that we celebrate it too much. So that's one area where we address diabetes with this, and when I come to the latter part of my talk, this introduction about eating will be more understandable. The second thing is that diabetes is about plumbing, is about tubes. These are very nice, brand new watering pipes. And this is the pipe which has been used for over 10 years. And you see a lot of rust inside. I hope you can see it. And once I was changing pipes in my house, and this is the pipe which I cut through, and it has plenty of rust here. I will be doing this, and if you could show it on the camera if I move, okay, so the other could see it. And this is the aorta of a person who had type 2 diabetes for 24 years, died in a car accident, and not because of myocardial infarction, but he was bound to have this fate soon anyway. And if you look at this aorta here, there is not a single healthy endothelial cell here. There are deposits of fat, plenty of cholesterol, all other fat. There are ulcerations, there is calcium. And if you heard the noise, I'm not sure if you've ever been at the autopsy, but when I was a student, I loved going to see autopsies because I wanted to see what a patient or what a man has inside. Anatomy was not convincing enough to me. And if you heard the sound of the scissors cutting along this aorta, you just hear the cracking through the calcium deposits. So this actually looked pretty similar, I thought. And this is what happens after a quarter of a century of diabetes. And that's actually the ultimate thing we are trying to prevent in type 2 diabetes, in any diabetes, in fact, but mostly in type 2 diabetes. So diabetes is not really about sugar, obesity is at its beginning, but it's about preventing vessels and peripheral nerves, so preventing vascular complications. And it's even biggest challenge, because if you tell any patient, if you will be eating half of the apple cake you prepare every day for your grandchildren, if you talk to a patient like this, within 10 years you will die, or you will have your leg amputated, or your eyeball will not be working anymore. People just can't understand it. What is the way from eating an apple cake or plum cake or whatever, or fruit? That's another myth, that fruit is healthy. Fruit is actually killing our patients. It's a water with sugar. I know it sounds very radical, but that's what fruit really is. I always tell my patients to start loving cauliflowers and cucumbers, But that's also spurious because we've already have strawberries, there will be cherries arriving any week now, and then plums start, and then grapes and oranges and tangerines, and so much lovers of plums we have in among diabetes patients, you will not find them anywhere else. And if they are my age or older, we all remember that fruit is something very healthy for you, and there is nothing healthiest actually, healthier than fruit, which is not true if you have diabetes. So that's a complicated way from the beginning of the disorders like hyperglycemia to that shape of vessels. So that's another challenge. And that, looking at this, is you're looking at a failure of diabetes treatment and at the same time of where our treatment is concentrated on. And we've been knowing it for decades, but we were unable to do anything about it, especially with diabetes treatment, until September 2015. And this is where this excitement with diabetology started among those who thought that it's just a very boring part of medicine when we tell obese people not to eat so much and exercise more, which is always futile. And it's really, I remember one of the cardiologists who told me, I don't know, 7-8 years ago, one of the leading cardiologists in this country, and he told me, look, all this diabetes is rubbish. It's just a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. It's not really a disease. So I didn't quarrel. You never quarrel with diabetes, with cardiologists or surgeons for that matter, but I knew he was wrong. And then I was right after September 2015. On the September 2015, exactly on the 17th of September, during our annual meeting of European Association for the Study of Diabetes, this paper was presented, where the drug which we really did not think seriously about, empagliflozin SGLT2 inhibitor, was suddenly shown that it's able, when used in people with type 2 diabetes, to decrease mortality by as little, and I'm saying it's ironically, it's a huge difference, 38%. And it wasn't because sugar was lowered. The idea for the number of studies, we call them cardiovascular outcome trials, they were run according to the recommendation of FDA. FDA in 2008, after a number of blunders with drugs for metabolic diseases, said, okay, for the companies who wanted to enter American market, and the American market with the drugs is a gold mine, they said, you can enter the market here, but you have to show that your drugs are safe from the cardiovascular point of view. So the drug entered the market and the companies immediately started, these kind of studies where patients were treated for diabetes in a standard way and they were just given placebo or empagliflozin. And then suddenly you see 40% reduction within 4 years in cardiovascular mortality, and what was even more important, that happened after a month or two of taking the drug. So that was clear, although it was difficult to accept for us, that it has nothing or very little to do with diabetes, with lowering blood glucose. In fact, the idea was that these two groups will have a similar blood glucose, exactly the same. It never happened. In all these studies, patients getting active compound had a little bit lower HbA1c, but just a little bit, 0.2, 0.3, without much clinical relevance. So this was a total mystery, and this is about the drug we really were laughing at, because the drug is causing glycosuria, the drug is blocking the transporter in the kidney, in the proximal tubule in the kidney, which reabsorbs back to the blood glucose and sodium. And once you block it, glucose, which is first excreted to something we can call primary urine, it just stays there and is excreted. And we thought, well, I remember the times when personal glucose meters arrived. And before that, we were just using urine samples to assess whether the patient is treated correctly. Every 2 weeks, a patient took a urine sample to the lab, and if there was no glucose there, then it's fine. Glucose is well controlled. And now we are causing mega glycosuria. It was glycosuria like first patients who we were giving these drugs I had number of cases like the phone call from the lab where someone told me, the lab employee told me, look, this patient, you refer the patient to us for the sampling of his urine, and he has such a high glycosuria that the head of our laboratory, who's been working 38 years, she's never seen anything like that. The kidneys of this man must be dying. He will come to you tomorrow, and you have to do something about it. Of course, the patient was informed that once he does urine sampling, there will be a lot of glucose in the urine, but patients tends to not remember about things like that. Now labs know it, but it's been over 10 years we have these drugs on the market. It's not the end of these benefits of these drugs. We also learned that the main driver for reducing cardiovascular mortality was reducing the risk for hospitalization for heart failure, which in more accessible terms simply improves heart function and decreases the risk of exacerbation of heart failure. How come? Initially we thought, oh, they are just those SGLT2 inhibitors. SGLT2 is sodium glucose cotransporter 2, and the inhibitors, all these flozins, are just intelligent diuretics, but that's not true. They do plenty of other things I will briefly show you in a moment, which actually help ailing heart to survive. Again, 35% reduction in the risk of going to hospital with worsening of heart failure. And in next 6 months, in June 2016, the results of EMPEROR outcome study regarding renal outcomes were presented at the meeting of American Society of Nephrologists. And this was even more surprising. Before this, if anyone asked me, and that's a huge lesson in being humble, modest, and there's a huge lesson that we have to do the studies, because all the results here I'm showing to you are just contraintuitive. The wisest diabetologist wouldn't really predict these results. The company which produces these drugs, Boehringer Ingelheim, makes empagliflozin, they didn't know how, why, they didn't expect these results. But if anyone asked me, okay, we have a drug which causes glycosuria, what do you think, how it will work on kidneys? I would say, well, thank God if kidneys don't die. I mean, because it's the risk of infections, pyelonephritis, so the patients will have even more problems. And it's exactly opposite. As you can see here, it's 39% reduction of the risk of occurring new cases of chronic kidney disease, diabetic chronic kidney disease, or worsening of thereof. And it's consistent and it starts early. And we understand the mechanism of that. It's actually decreasing the diameter of the afferent arterioli, which brings blood to the glomeruli. It decreases the pressure inside glomeruli and decreases proteinuria, and thus it saves the kidneys. It very nicely supplements or goes together with the effect which like ACE inhibitors have, because they dilate the efferent arterioli, which also decreases the pressure in the glomeruli. So suddenly we receive the drugs, which actually decreases macro and microvascular complications in type 2 diabetes. And that's the summary of the study. I have no conflict of interest here. My talk is not sponsored by any company. I'm just showing you the pioneering drug in this history here. I will show you just the data, briefly the data on other agents from this group. And this is an absolutely impressive result. As impressive that with this reduction of heart failure, the drugs has been officially taken over by cardiologists about 2-3 years ago, and they are now recommended to be used in heart failure equally with diuretics, with beta blockers, with ACE inhibitors, and I think they will be actually the first ones to be used in heart failure, regardless whether the patient has or has not diabetes. And then more studies came, because each company which produced SGLT2 inhibitor wanted to show, okay, our drug is safe. And this is the most important outcome. It's cardiovascular death. This is what you've just seen, EMPEROR outcome results. Two other studies, like with canagliflozin and dapagliflozin, showed no effect on cardiovascular disease. But this was an extremely interesting study, Verities, with ertugliflozin. This is the molecule made by MSD, by Merck. And here you can see that these curves are superimposable. There is not a minimal effect on cardiovascular mortality. And In these two studies, the explanation was, well, the group was here, for example, were the healthiest people among all those four groups. So if you took the very healthy people, you have to follow them for much longer time to see how many of them would die. But these two studies, EMPIRIC Outcome and VERITIS, had the same type of patients. Actually, in VERITIS, they were even more sick. How sick? In EMPIRIC Outcome, half of the patients had already myocardial infarction, three quarters had coronary heart disease, a quarter already had a stroke at baseline. This is a very complicated, the cohort of type 2 diabetes patients with advanced complications, much greater rate than we see at our regular practices. Here, there were even more cases of stroke and myocardial infarction, still no effect. So the idea of class effect of these drugs fell. We just stopped talking about class effect within cardiovascular mortality reduction. We concentrate on empagliflozin, and of course the producer is happy. But these drugs really reshaped and changed thoroughly the way we treat patients. We stopped lowering blood glucose. We started to lower blood glucose still, but we actually started to prolong our patients' lives. And if you look at, are these drugs different? If you look at heart failure, the effect is the same in all these studies. So this is a class effect. And that's even more interesting for science, for research. If in EMPIRIC Outcome and VERITIS, the results of cardiovascular death were so different, still the effect of heart failure was similar. How come? What are the mechanisms? So these are actually, with all the respect of my predecessors, these are actually, this is one of two areas most studied in diabetes. How SGLT2 inhibitors work, what they do, how they help. Because it's not just cardiology, it's nephrology in a moment. This is the, again, a class effect on lowering. This all should be green. I don't know why it's just blue and green. It's always green. So all these studies, all those four molecules we have in Poland, and they are available worldwide, they showed reduction in renal risk, reduction in progression of nephropathy. And nephrologists are the third group which are stealing or taking these drugs from us and putting them in their recommendation. This is one of the simplest figures presenting what SGLT2 inhibition does in our body if we take it. And I already mentioned what happens with glucose, about kidneys, but it also increases erythropoiesis and increases also hematocrit, which is easy to imagine. Because what happens if you block SGLT2 and glucose stays in the urine, people usually the amount, the volume of urine increases by about quarter to half liter, 250 to 500 milliliters per day. So there is a clear diuretic effect. You also lose calories, because with glucose, patients lose about 300 calories per day, they lose weight. So there's also the benefit. There is no hypoglycemia with these drugs. Losing calories also decreases steatosis in the liver, which is common in every overweight, not just obese patient. So hepatologists are the next group which will be interested in these drugs. And they are basically extremely safe. The only side effect is mycotic infection of genital organs. Amazingly, no bacterial infections of urinary tract. So UTIs, no more often than in patients taking placebo, just balanitis, well, just, it could be pretty awkward, but it happens in 5 to 10% of patients, more often in females. All in all, the action of these drugs help heart to survive. And this is what we offered cardiologists from this humble diabetology, and we are extremely proud of it, because they started to respect us a little bit. So that's one reason why type 2 why diabetology is really becoming a fascinating thing. The second thing is this, and this is, I'm now referring, and there is a connection between previous lectures and here. We heard already GLP-1's GIP. GLP-1, glucagon-like peptide, just for us, for all of us to understand what it does, it's one of the ways the intestines let know the whole body something has just been eaten. The message goes to the pancreas and insulin is released, to alpha cells in the pancreas and glucagon secretions decreased, to the brain with increasing satiety center, and also to stomach to decrease gastric emptying. This is one of the three ways to stimulate insulin release from beta cells. One is increasing glucose concentration. The second is neurological. Beta cells and the islets have their own neurological innervation, autonomic, of course. And this is a hormonal way. And it has been known for over 100 years that there is something in duodenum, because the experiments were done in 1920s, that if you take duodenum, if you mix it and make an extract and give it to rats, their glucose, blood glucose, is lowering. And no one knows how it happened. And the guy who did it and showed it was Michael Nauck in 1986, very recently. And it was his project as a very young PhD student, the first project he didn't want to do. It was the lab of Professor Creutzfeldt in Germany. And that's the lesson from this. And also this guy, there is another incretin, because they are called incretin hormones. If you heard this name, you may think it's stupid, incretin hormones, but it comes from in, from intestine, and cre, from pancreas. So it's intestinal pancreatic axis. And Dan Drucker is a guy whose origins are from Jewish families in Eastern Poland from before Second World War. He's from Canada. And he also, when he graduated, he wanted to do research in thyroid. And his boss told him to study hormones of gastrointestinal tract. He also didn't want to do it. So to any young students or young doctors listening to us, you should trust your bosses, because don't trust your intuition when you're young. Just trust your bosses. They probably know better what will be evolving and developing in science in next years. So we learned about GLP-1s, analogs or receptor agonists, in 2003, so it's almost 20 years ago. This is one of the first studies showing these drugs. And when the first drug from this group, exenatide, was compared with long-acting insulin analog, you see that the action in lowering blood glucose is actually the same. So the power to lower elevated blood glucose by GLP-1 is exactly the same as insulin. And these are the results we also found very difficult to believe, because in our diabetological religion, insulin is God, and there is no greater God than insulin, and nothing can beat insulin's action. Apparently, GLP-1 can. And at the same time, on glargine, on this insulin analog, people gained weight. With exenatide, they lost weight. And I'm not showing you the data, but there is also no hypoglycemia here. And we understand it why. And the beauty of action of GLP-1 in diabetes is that it stimulates insulin secretion, but in a glucose-dependent way. If there is normal glycemia, if glucose level is normal, then the pathway, GLP-1 has its own receptor, and it triggers number of activation of kinases through CAMP, and it's just not active. And we understand why. It's about calcium ions not entering the cell in the milieu of normoglycemia. And just to make a long story short, the same studies like with SGLT2 inhibitors were done with GLP-1 analogs. And you see the studies here. In Poland, we have three drugs. We are using three drugs, liraglutide, semaglutide, and dulaglutide. And all these drugs showed the reduction in MACE. These are the main cardiovascular events. And MACE3 means that there are three events are put together here in the calculations. It's cardiovascular death, and it's non-fatal MI and non-fatal stroke. So basically all MIs and strokes. And the decrease in MACE reduction is really impressive. In EMPEROR outcome, MACE was reduced by 14%. Here we have 26 with semaglutide. We have also the decrease in non-fatal stroke risk by 40%. So now we believe GLP-1s are able to decrease atherosclerosis. But again, it's the same story with the SGLT2s. We're decreasing the risk of death, we're extending patients' lives, and of course we lower blood glucose, but we fight very effectively vascular complications. The action of GLP-1s on the whole body is very complex, and this is, we actually know much less how GLP-1 what it does in the body than SGLT2 inhibitor. What we know is that in obese people and people with type 2 diabetes, GLP-1, of course, is produced by the, and I very like this, very much like this, because it very nice coincides with the previous lecture. There's a kind of a chain, I guess, amino acid chain. GLP-1, by the way, is a smaller hormone than insulin. It has 30 plus amino acids, and insulin has over 50. So this is produced in people who are obese and have type 2 diabetes, but somehow the action is weakened. We don't know why. We don't use the phrase GLP-1 resistance, but there is something like this. And with administering GLP-1 analogs, we are increasing the level, plasma level of GLP-1s, some 5-6-fold, and it's absolutely safe. We have about, you may always worry that if you use too much hormones, you will cause some problems, like if a patient will be overdosing thyroxine, for example. However, hormones, and that's also, I guess, clinically an interesting thing to know, that many hormones have no top or maximum doses. Insulin has no maximum doses as a drug. Morphine has no maximum doses, but that's another story. But insulin has no. Probably GLP-1 we could use in much higher doses we are using, simply we should get the effect. But that's a more complex picture, and the newer one from 2018, what GLP-1 does. And as you can see, it acts on all organs, all tissues. It can even improve bone formation. But what we most like is here on glucose and that. And then I will show you why my talk is a little bit contradictory to the two first ones, and why I would argue bariatric surgery, we are now should see the beginning of its dawn. No, twilight, sorry, dawn is at the beginning of the day, twilight, dusk. I'll show you why in a moment. That's what started to change our thinking. The number one drug in this group is semaglutide. The trade name, and I'm not doing any advertising, is Ozempic. I guess someone must be taking Ozempic here, because everyone is taking Ozempic now. Everyone wants to lose weight, and you can't buy this drug in any pharmacy. Novo Nordisk company, which is producing it, just has just experienced huge blunder, failure. Drug is just unavailable. We are prescribing dulaglutide, which is called Trulicity now, but it will also disappear from the market in the next couple of weeks. Ozempic has gone already. Why? This is the study with semaglutide in patients with type 2 diabetes and who are obese at a dose which is higher than a dose we use to treat diabetes. The maximum dose which is licensed, registered for semaglutide for diabetes is 1 milligram per week. We give this drug subcutaneously, but once a week. It's an extremely comfortable way of administration of the drug. We also had to learn it. These drugs, the first one was dulaglutide, Trulicity 5 years ago, Ozempic arrived 2.5 years ago. And we were surprised. We were thinking, well, we really teach our patients to take insulin up to 4 times a day, sometimes even 5. How come a drug which would be taken once weekly would work? And they work marvelously. But the Novo Nordisk did the same what they did with liraglutide, which is also registered for treating just obesity at a higher doses than in diabetes. Instead of 1 milligram, they tested 2.4. And this is the paper from the Lancet, so you can't get better. New England is better only in clinical science. And what you can see here, that 1 milligram is blue, 2.4 is red, and they are equally effective in terms of lowering HbA1c. So we might say, come on, not better, more than double the dose, still the same effect on glucose. But that's an extremely important figure, because what happens here, patients with HbA1c over 8%, which is much too high for any patient, they are able to get to 6.5. This is the target for, that's the best control of diabetes you can realistically achieve within, not very quickly, it takes a few weeks, regardless of the dose. What it means? It means that there is no risk of hypoglycemia, there is no risk of overdosing GLP-1s in terms of glucose control. But look what happens with body weight. There is a 7 kilograms decrease over a year on 1 milligram and almost 10 kilograms on 2.4. But that's not all. In February last year, another part of STEP program was published. This is New England, with semaglutide 2.4 in obesity. And here, about a year, you had a reduction of body weight of about 16 kilograms. We've never had such drugs for obesity and for diabetes, for that matter. Never, ever. Safely, the only side effect is just mild nausea. If you use the drug carefully, it means we start at lower doses and we increase the dose, escalate the dose over the month or two. If you can hear in what I'm saying a grain of enthusiasm, you are right, because we are really thrilled with what we can achieve. Just by sitting here, I open my computer, which is there, and I just got an email from a patient. What I usually do, I prescribe these drugs for a couple of months, then I have no time to see all the patients who wants to see me. You probably don't know it, but I'm one of the doctors. Many people believe that I can cure them from diabetes by touching them or talking to them, so they bring me patients from all over Poland. I never say no to any patient, but I just have no time to see all of them as often as they would like once they see me. So I do a lot of medical counseling over email or telephone once I know the patients and have my notes. So one of the patients just wrote here, and it's true, I'm not making it up, and he said, thank you very much for the therapy you prescribed me. I've been taking semaglutide for over 6 months now. I lost 15 kilos. I want to lose 10 more, but I can't buy it. Could you prescribe Rybelsus? Rybelsus is an oral semaglutide which has just been available in the last few months. It has to be taken once daily. We still have little experience, but it's again a revolution. We have a protein, which is a GLP-1 analog, put in a pill, and you can swallow it, and it can get absorbed. So I guess the Novo Nordisk company has also insulin in pills already, but they keep it in safe because they have too many factories to produce subcutaneous insulin. And it all happened in the last few years. If I came to you those 8-9 years ago, I would give you the most boring lecture imaginable. The talk just before me would be extremely exciting. Sorry, I would be the most boring. But within the last 3-5 years, really has changed a lot. This one picture, this one figure, made FDA to license to register semaglutide, and this is the name of the preparation, Wegovy 2.4 once weekly for chronic weight management. As it says here, since 2013, there was no drug for obesity. And US is just a paradise for any obesity drug maker, you can imagine. That's why we don't have drug here, because all semaglutide is shipped to US, because everyone is in US is taking it. And I believe everyone in Poland would be taking it. Everyone wants to lose weight. Those who are slim ones wants to lose 2 kilos. Those who are obese ones wants to lose 22 kilos. Everyone, I don't know any person who doesn't want to lose weight. All women, and maybe 90% men. So you see what happens. And this is all through diabetology and diabetes care. But that's not the end of the story. And this is where I arrive to the conclusion that bariatric surgery will lose its position, although I'm as fascinated as my predecessors. I will just explain in a moment. This is the study which was published just a month ago, month and a half ago, in April, with a drug which is called tirzepatide. And tirzepatide is a dual or double agonist. It's GLP-1 receptor agonist and GIP agonist. That's another incretin hormone, glucose-dependent insulinotropic peptide. It used to be called gastric inhibitory peptide. And look what happens with people who are just obese. They have 105 kilograms of baseline body weight, and after a year, they lose 23.6 kilograms with almost no side effects. I hope I have your attention and made an impression. And this is the paper we published 10 years ago, and there's my name here somewhere. Yeah, the last one. Because I was working in Łódź for 20 years, and in 1998 we started a obesity surgery in patients who are obese and with diabetes. Professor Janusz Strzelczyk, who's now the head of the department, came from Leeds in UK after 3 years, fascinated with bariatric surgery, and started the program. We, as internists and diabetologists, we were on the first floor, surgery was on the third floor. We were seeing these patients before and after surgery, and we were extremely skeptical as internists. One of the golden rules of the internal medicine in medicine is do everything you can that your patient is not treated by a surgeon. And I apologize all the future surgeons here or surgeons who are listening to us, but that's about the complications. If you cut somebody's body, he's bound to die more often than if I just give them pills. So we were very skeptical because it's so easy. You just tell the fat people, oh, you're just bloody so awfully fat. Can't you eat less and just walk more and you'll be slim as much as you like? That doesn't work. But when we saw the results in first 5, 10, 20 patients, and we saw how beautifully they lose weight, how their diabetes resolves, that's the only way to treat someone from, to cure from someone from type 2 diabetes surgery. We became fascinated. We did plenty of studies. We were the ones, and I hope that the paper would be quoted by my predecessors, we in which were the first one to describe bariatric surgery effects, and it was published in Diabetes Care, so you can't get better in diabetes, I'm boasting now, in type 1 diabetes patients who were obese. This is the first report. This is one of the most often cited paper from our department when I worked in Łódź. And this is the Polish paper. It says the results of bariatric surgery, how patients see it. And I just want to see you, to show you one figure. That's 6 months after the surgery, yes, with baseline body weight much higher than the previous paper, but still, after 6 months, you have 25 kilograms of body weight. And just to compare, you have 23.6, basically the same after a year, but with a lower baseline weight. But that's comparable. So what we are thinking, what we will be, I guess, putting in our recommendations, maybe not this year, for sure not this year, in the middle of 2022, but next year, or 2 years from now, for sure, we'll be saying, anyone who's morbidly obese, before considering and being accepted for surgical treatment, has to go GLP-1 receptor agonist therapy for at least 6 months, a year. The catch is that about 20% people treated with GLP-1 receptor agonists do not respond with significant weight loss, and we don't know why. There is no way, we know there must be something with genetic polymorphism of GLP-1 receptor, but we cannot really assess it in our offices. So 1 out of 5 will not lose weight as much as it could. But there are people, and I have patients like that, who lost 30 kilos in 1 year. And that's one of the things I've never thought that as an internal medicine doctor I would be able to see such happy patients. There's the lady coming to me after 1 year of treatment with GLP-1, with semaglutide, and she comes to me after a year, 30 kilos lighter. I can't recognize her. She has, and that's what Dr. Brzozowska showed, she probably not yet divorced, but she's about to start new life, changing the place where she lives. It's just like being reborn. She's just over the moon. She's excited and delighted. She wants to kiss my hand that I gave her such a drug. And I said, I have nothing to be credited for. It's just a drug. It's the progress of medicine. But the curse here is, so it's extreme pleasure. It's a satisfaction the highest you can have, not being a surgeon, but treating people with injections or pills. But the downside of this is that she leaves the office, and next to her come 30 or 20 or 15 colleagues, also filmmakers from her office, saying, we also want to lose 30 kilos of body weight that she did. And they will not. And then after another 6 months or 10 months, one of her colleagues comes to me and says, look, she lost 30 and I lost only 12. And do something about it. I want to lose 30. Well, my response is today I have nothing much to do, but then we will be prescribing this at the end of this year. It will be available in Poland at the end of this year. But I'm just saying, look, can you remember any moment you lost 12 kilos of your body weight? You're awful fat lady, I'm thinking, not saying. Yeah, I do hate patients. I can make a confession. There are patients, the number of patients I do hate is just increasing. But I admit it to myself, and I usually hate them because they're just awful people. But yeah, I'm honest with it. Yeah. But I don't, I'm charming to everyone the same way. I hope they will like me and trust me. I am able to gain their trust in the first 3 minutes of the visit. Even I would kill them once I see them. And the moment I can talk about it freely, and it's not a joke, it's true. And the longer I work, the more patients I hate and would kill. And I will one day. That will be the last day of my work, but I will. I have three candidates I think I will kill, and I will be the happiest patient and person on earth. But at the moment I realized I hate them, I thought, okay, I hate them, I have right to hate them. My emotions, I have right to do so. But they are entitled to receive the best service possible from me. And because I hate them, I might be inclined not to do things properly. So I'm extremely careful to do everything medical knowledge tells me to do. So I do all the checkups, and when they have indication for colonoscopy, I just pick up the phone and call the endoscopy department and says, look, this is this lady, she's so poor, her husband just hanged himself last week, she's got 7 children, and she's got clear indication for colonoscopy, can you schedule it for the next week? And it is scheduled for the next week. And if a patient who I like comes to me and I think, oh, she needs colonoscopy, and I think, oh, colonoscopy, this is a horrible examination. Maybe we will repeat feces for blood and then we will do colonoscopy. And that's wrong. You either have indications for colonoscopy or you haven't. Yeah. So when I realize that patients who I hate have even better care than patients who I like, now I hate freely. That's the confession of an old doctor, not related to the talk. But anyway, that just shows I'm a real practitioner. So you see my point. We are able to achieve the results which bariatric surgeons gave us. And you will not find a greater enthusiast of bariatric surgery than me in this room, I believe. I really been seeing patients over 20, a quarter of century. But still, drugs are doing better. So, I'm just coming to an end, just a few more slides. Sorry, I took too much time, but I see you listen, so it really helps me talk. And we will answer all your questions. So, the reason why diabetology has become so fascinating now, and I would bet it's the best part of medicine now, and it will be for quite a few years ahead, because we are treating the patients who are obese and have diabetes are just counted in millions in any country who has at least 1 million inhabitants, and we have almost 40 and getting more with our refugees. So we have plenty of patients and we can really help them. If this god or this three-phase sculpture would be SGLT2 inhibitor or GLP-1 analog, they could say three things. I'm lowering blood glucose and body weight, I'm lowering the risk of macroangiopathy, and I'm lowering the risk of microangiopathy. But that's not the end of story. There is one other part which makes diabetes care even more exciting, and that's a new technology. And I'm just giving you a hint about it. There's no time to talk about it in details. This is, anyone knows what it is? Has anyone see it? Yeah, that's a FreeStyle Libre. You've seen it. Or I should finish it. I'm finishing, just 3 more slides, sorry. This is the glucose sensor. I'm not advertising any company, but it's the only company, Abbott, is producing it. It's available and it's very easy to use. This works for 2 weeks, doesn't need any calibration. Patients use their phones and they can read their glucose 1,000 times a day. And it's brilliant. We just love it. Patients send us the scans from the phone. We can exchange their ID numbers, and I have virtual, it's called LibreView, virtual office, and I can follow their blood glucose levels. I don't want to do it. I hate to do it. But if I need it, I can. And in some patients, it's necessary. We publish heavily now about it, how to use it. These, you can see my first name here. I'm just the predecessor showed their own study, so I just wanted also to show that, make myself a little bit more credible. The real science is there, by the way. I'm just an entertainer. This is the real science. All those unfolded, misfolded proteins, this is where the knowledge comes from. Now you see, Voltaire, you know, the French philosopher, once said that the art of medicine is about entertaining the patient when the nature heals him. And I think this is a lot, tells a lot about my practice. So you see most of the leading diabetologists here. I happen to be the first author, but just to be honest, not because I'm the wisest. If you look here, it's an alphabetical order. So if your name, surname starts with A, lucky you. If your surname starts with Z, and this is the president of our association, well, the senior is okay, but this one, no one will remember here. This is one of the past presidents. So I'm glad that my name, it's a horrible name to pronounce when you're English, but in English, but it's C is okay, and I'm glad they didn't invite anyone who starts with A or B. And Libre and Adi, we have about three other systems for continuous glucose monitoring, CGMs. They produce such a report, and it looks complicated, it is not. With just one glance, we see how much time patient spends in target range, which is now 70 to 180 milligrams per deciliter, how much time in hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia range. We see the average of 2 week records and every day here. And then we can analyze it with the patient. It's like I'm comparing it to driving a car. And if you use a glucose meter and you measure your blood glucose four times a day, which is a lot for many patients, it's like driving a car and opening your eyes four times during this drive. That's it. Once you know the glucose, you know what insulin to take, how much, what to eat, how to exercise. Here, you drive through your diabetes with your eyes open. The data from CGM is made to our recommendations. This is international recommendations. We repeat them in our Polish recommendations. What should be the target range? So during the day, how much time patients should spend in different target ranges. You see in pregnancy, they are lower and more narrow. This is the general 70 to 180. And it should be in general, in type 1, then type 2. It's not just type 1. Over 70%. So we learn how to use it in clinical practice as well. And it's not just a gadget, and it's not just a diagnostic tool. This is the seminal study published just 2 years ago by our friends in Czech Republic, and I know half of the authors here, and we truly envy them this paper. It's in Diabetes Care, but it's a good envy. It's not bad envy. We are proud in a way. What they did here, they took patients with type 1 diabetes, treated with MDI, multiple daily injections of continuous subcutaneous insulin infusion, which is pumps, and they subdivided them into patients who are using SMBG, self-monitoring of blood glucose, which is glucose meter, or using CGMs. This is a different type of CGM which stops insulin infusion when glucose is too low. And you see that introducing any form of CGM lowered HbA1c by 1% over the period of 3 years. If something lowers blood glucose, it's not a diagnostic tool, it's a therapeutic tool. I hope you're with me. So something which has been seen by us for years, I've been knowing the systems for over 20 years. The first one I had in my hands was made by Medtronic in 2001. And we thought it will be only used in research. It's too sophisticated to be used in clinical practice. Now we can use it. And it lowers further blood glucose. And the revolutionary meaning of this paper is that it doesn't really matter whether you use insulin pump or multiple injections. And until this paper, we thought pumps are always better. That's the highest standard. We could put everyone on pumps. The only barrier is finances and sort of educational barriers. But that's not true. You can achieve excellent glucose control just using CGMs. And the final part are pumps. This is the first insulin pump, not very handy, as you can see here. That's one of the more recent sensor communicating with a pump. And the patient see here glucose levels here and the curves profiles and decides on insulin dose to be administered. But that's the latest what we have by Medtronic, 780G, 780G. And that's the pump, which is the half artificial pancreas, because it works in a closed loop. And closed loop, the phrase you might have heard, you will be here more and more, is working. Sensor gives a signal through Bluetooth to the pump, and the pump decides itself, based on the algorithms which are inside, how much insulin should be given. Glucose is changing, it influences the readings from the sensor, and so on, so on. So it's a closed loop. And this pump works as a closed loop at night. And that's a revolution for children with type 1 diabetes because parents no longer have to get up overnight and measure their blood glucose. They can be safe that overnight the child will have good blood glucose because that pump works as an artificial pancreas, as pancreas. And if you ever talk to a type 1 patient and if you ask them, what is the greatest burden of the disease to you? They wouldn't say insulin injections, hypoglycemias, or I have to follow some dietary instructions, although they are very, we use basically free diet now in type 1. The greatest burden is that they have the awareness, they have to think about diabetes all the time. Sometime at the back of their head, they're thinking, okay, what I'm going to do for the next few hours? Can I exercise? How much insulin should I take? This is on my plate, but I will go swimming or not swimming. That's the burden. You have to plan your life. And if you're young, it's extremely difficult. The pump, which are now becoming to be closed loop, will free them from this burden. So there's another revolution, which is just around the corner. It's only the question of sensors, reading the glucose fast enough, and insulin is given subcutaneously acting fast enough. And when they will be fast enough, also the meal boluses will be given in closed loops here, the patient has to administer it. And that's my last slide. Sorry for taking too much time, but I see you're interested. So they always, you know, if you want the lecture to close and finish quickly, you either should snore loudly, and that would decrease all the enthusiasm from the speaker, or start to clap. Then, if you start clapping, I can't continue. It's perhaps rude, but works. So what is exciting about diabetes today? Three things. That new therapies allow us to treat type 2 diabetes effectively without hypoglycemia. Those two drug groups cause no hypos. Without weight gain, and actually with weight loss. SGLT2s and GLP-1s cause weight loss. They also reduce the risk of micro and macroangiopathy, which is great. And they really look like ideal drugs for type 2 diabetes. We get the glucose to near normal levels. We decrease the risk of complications with minimal side effects. And new methods of glucose monitoring, which is really based on space technology. Patients do not appreciate it, but technology which is in these sensors are really of space level. They enter clinical practice and they really thoroughly changed the patient's view and patient's understanding of diabetes. And so has ours. We also now start to see diabetes differently, and to change the view of the doctors extremely difficult. And as I said, artificial technological, not bionic, not islet transplantations, I don't think it will ever work at a large group of patients, maybe in individual cases. But basically, artificial pancreas pumps with CGMs is just around the corner. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Professor Czupryniak, thank you so much for your splendid presentation on such an innovative approach to the management of patients with diabetes. And now we are going to focus on the reimbursement rates in different European Union countries. Our first-year medical student Anessa Achmatowicz and sixth-year medical student Daniel Minges-Gala are going to present the results of the English Division students' original contribution to this event. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a warm welcome, please.
Dzień dobry, ladies and gentlemen. Today we will be talking about the reimbursement rate for diabetes in different European countries. And before I begin, let me first thank the authorities for giving us the opportunity to speak today. And a very special thank you to Professor Sadowski for helping us when we had the help needed and for being available all the time. Okay. Today we will be looking at different reimbursement rates for different management, self-management and treatments for diabetes. Looking at the healthcare in different countries, we will start with Poland. Poland is situated with a statutory, also known as the public health care. Seniors over 75 years have free access to a lot of medications, and diabetics as well as other chronically ill patients mostly have a 70% reimbursement rate, as though it's very hard to say because the reimbursement system in Poland is very complex, and so you can't really give a discrete number. In Germany, the public health care consists about 88% of the German citizens, with about 10% of the citizens in the private healthcare and the other 2% in healthcare, especially for military or doctors. Excluded groups from payments are minimal pensioners, children and welfare aides, as well as many others, but we can't mention them in this short presentation. In general, Germany has a payment border of about 2% of the brutto income, with 1% for chronically ill patients. Norway consists of the national insurance scheme, also called NIS, and has the ability to provide for voluntary private co-payments for faster access or other services. Also, Norway has an exemption card, also called the blue prescription, for chronically ill patients, which says that when you pay more than 2,921 Norwegian krona, which are about 285 euros, that everything after this sum will be reimbursed. Also, the one-time payment in Norway cannot exceed over 520 Norwegian krona, which are about 51 euro and 43 cents. In Spain, the last European country that we will compare with the others, the public health system is called InSalud and is for the social security. Each community in Spain is responsible for providing their own InSalud services, so there will be and can be slight differences. The private healthcare co-payments are also in Spain available for faster access, and some jobs and most government jobs give their employees additional access to the private healthcare, and it is a mutually exclusive with the public system. The guidelines for diabetes in Spain are provided by the Sociedad Española de Diabetes. When we look at the evaluation of hyperglycemia, we can see that in the most countries for pre-diabetes, we focus on the intermittent fasting glucose and the oral glucose tolerance test, as well as the glycated hemoglobin. The only difference in pre-diabetes we can clearly see is that Spain is focusing on the glycated hemoglobin. In type 2 diabetes, the laboratory parameters are all very, very similar, as well as for the type 1 diabetes. And looking at our main topic, the reimbursement rate, we can see that all countries except Norway reimburse the evaluation of hyperglycemia 100%. In Norway, you have to pay 59 Norwegian krona as self-payment. The diagnostic for the latent autoimmune diabetes in adults is reimbursed very differently, as you can see on this slide. We can see that the detection of antibodies, for example in Poland, is fully reimbursed in Germany as well, but the preventive checkups are only reimbursed every 2 years for patients over 35 years. Children and adolescents are completely reimbursed and are for free. In Norway, the laboratory costs have to be provided by the patient. These are 75 Norwegian krona and 375 Norwegian krona for seeing a specialist, in this case, the diabetologist. In Spain, also the detection of antibodies is completely reimbursed. And as we can see, the phenotypic diagnosis and the other criteria for the reimbursement of the LADA diagnosis are lean or low BMI. In case from Germany, for example, it is a BMI of under 25, and also the family history of autoimmune diseases, no effect of oral antidiabetics, and no diabetes mellitus in family, as well as a young age of the diagnosis of diabetes mellitus 2. Metformin, for example, is very complicated to explain, at least for the Polish system, because the reimbursement rate differs depending on the tablet sizes and also the milligram size. For example, 0% has to be paid by seniors over 75 years. Otherwise, the patients have to pay a lump sum, which, like I said, differs from the size of the package. In Germany, you usually pay 10% of the self-costs, so 10% with a minimum of 5 euro and a maximum of 10 euro have to be paid by the patient. In Norway, the medication has to be paid by the patients with a self-cost of 39%, and in the deductible zone that I just mentioned before, with a one-time payment that cannot be exceeded by 520 Norwegian krona. In Spain, also the 10% rule of self-cost can be applied with a maximum of 4.23 euro for metformin. When we are looking at the payment borders in different European countries, we can see that, for example, Poland and Spain do not have any payment border. And when we compare it to Germany, we can see that the usual patients have a payment border of 2% yearly and 1% for chronically ill patients. In Norway, as I have just mentioned, the chronically ill and also the diabetics in this included have the yearly border of 2,921 Norwegian krona and are entitled to the blue prescription and get the metformin then reimbursed. When we look at the examples here on the left, we can see that in Poland, 1,000 milligram of metformin in a 100 tablet package costs 27 zloty, and after a lump sum for the chronically ill patients, we can see that the patient has to pay 6 zloty, and the senior over 75 years pays 0 zloty, so it is for free. On the other hand, in Germany, we can see that the metformin 500 with 180 tablets usually costs 15 euro and 70 cents, and with the prescription for the diabetics only 5 euros. In Norway, we can see that the metformin 500 and 180 tablets, compared to Germany, it is the same size, costs about 18 euros and the price for the patient 7 euros. And for Spain, we can see that 850 milligram of 50 tablets costs 1 euro and 94 cents for the patients. And also keep in mind the wages and the differences of the wages in the countries to be able to compare these fully. And now I will give the word to my colleague.
So next up we have the self-monitoring of blood glucose. This is the main difference in most countries apart from the medication. In terms of the testing kits and needles for pens, the things you use to measure with the glucometer and such, we have in Poland 30% of the prices is covered by the insurance. In Germany, there's a copayment that is of the 10% with a minimum of 5 euros per patient and a maximum of 10. And if you want a monthly supply, you have a 10 euro payment. Then in Norway, you have the 39% of prices to a maximum of 520 corona. Then you will have to start paying on your own. And in Spain, it's fully reimbursed. Spain also includes the ability to not only give you the glucose strips, but also give you a free glucometer to every patient that is diagnosed with diabetes or pre-diabetes. This is also the case for Poland and Germany, but meanwhile in Norway, again, only 39% of the price and 520 crowns, which equates to around 52 euros. Now, for the continued glucose monitoring, either with a flash system or anything else, in Poland, it's only for diabetes mellitus type 1, and in which case it's 70% of the cost, and only if the patient does not have an hypoglycemia. Then for the real-time glucose monitoring, the reimbursement is only when the patients don't feel that hypoglycemia, and it has a built-in alarm system. And meanwhile, with the intermittent scanning glucose monitoring system, it's usually fully reimbursed. Now, obviously, the more convenient system is the real-time, because as soon as your glucose goes above or below a certain point, it will give you an alarm. But meanwhile, with the intermittent monitoring, it's only every 15 minutes, so the patient might not have an idea of what they can do while they wait for that result. In Norway, again, 39% of the price, 520 crowns. And meanwhile, in Spain, it is fully reimbursed with the flash monitoring system that we saw in the previous presentation. It used to only be available for patients with type 2 diabetes, but now in 2022, it's also fully reimbursed for patients with type 1 diabetes. In terms of the organization of care, as in when the patient can go to the doctor, what they can do, what is recommended, we can see that in Poland the recommendation is around 1 year. In Norway it's 1 year and a visit of two to four times a year. And in Norway it's 1 year recommended, but if you want to have a more frequent visitation or more follow-up, you will have to pay around 375 crowns or 37.5 euros. In Spain, the recommendation is 1 year, but you can still go at any time. For the care, the diabetes educator, so the person who is going to tell you how to manage your diabetes, what to eat, what to do, what to avoid, is completely free, as well as the dietitian that makes a plan for you. In Germany, they have nurse dieticians at home to measure your glucose and do a general checkup, and 4 weeks of therapy by nurses to a maximum of 3 times per day, and all of this is also fully reimbursed. Meanwhile, in Norway, you have diabetic teams, a specialist nurse, and a nutritionist, but to get access to this, you have to fill out the NOCLUS diabetes form. Finally, in Spain, we also have the system of free nurse visitations at home when needed, and every patient can just walk into the clinic every morning and get their glucose measured, as well as other parameters like the blood pressure and such that affect the treatment. In terms of the laboratory diagnostic, in every single European country, once the doctor gives you the form, it is completely free, but in Norway you do have to pay around 5 euros for it. In the terms of disease management programs, Poland and Norway don't have any eminent ones, but Germany has an insurance type of program in which every time a patient signs up, they gain 128 euros, so it's very interesting for the companies to get people to sign on to this, which you know ends up in a overall better wellness of the society. And in Spain, you have the diabetes sanitary campaign. Pretty much every patient in Spain gets automatically signed up into this campaign, and that is why we have the 10% of prices for the drugs, because every prescription that is part of this campaign, which every diabetic has access to, will get these prices. Finally, in the access to medical professional and health beneficial courses, Poland fully reimburses the ophthalmologist and nephrologist for 1 visit per year, and in diabetes mellitus type 1, 5 years after diabetes. However, for type 2 diabetes, it is immediately. In Germany, it's planned via the DMP system. It's fully reimbursed, and 2 health courses must be done, as well as being fully reimbursed. Norway only covers the ophthalmologist every second year, and every patient, however, has the right of education about the diabetes, like we mentioned before. And in Spain, it's fully reimbursed. You can have as many visitations as you need. In terms of the mental condition, in Poland, patients usually fill in a self-report, but also get an interview with the psychiatrist. As we know, one of the most important factors of the diabetes management is the attitude of the patient, and as well as knowing how to manage them. And in Germany, they use the PET scale and an interview. Norway has self-report forms again, and the anxiety depression scale. And in Spain, usually the family doctor will give you a referral to the psychiatrist, and an interview will follow. However, this is the problem with the socialized systems of medicine that we have here. In every single one, waiting times for psychiatrists are incredibly long. So patients might be waiting around for a long time until they get a visit, which might worsen their condition. However, in Norway, they have the MIN, you know, psychiatric interview, and since the payment for these services has slightly increased costs regarding to other countries, the waiting lists are shorter. Poland has a fully reimbursed mental condition assessment when it is necessary. In Germany, it's the same, and in Spain as well. And in Norway, sadly, it's only 3 visitations that are covered. Finally, in terms of the treatment, Germany, Norway, and Spain fully reimburse the cost of a diabetes mellitus type 1 insulin pump. However, for Poland, it's only reimbursed for people that are less than 26 years old, and a 70% refund for people above 26. Then again, people that are 75 or higher will also get a slower rate. In terms of diabetes mellitus type 2, it's an increased cost when comparing to diabetes mellitus type 1. Norway, it's only 39% of the cost. In Spain, again, 20% of the cost is there covered under the national campaign. In Germany, the reimbursement is a maximum of 10 euros with the copayment. And the multiple exchangeable pens, that is a pen that you can reuse just by changing the needle, is not covered. In Poland, it's mixed, 98 zloty for diabetics and 98 for people, whilst it's only 7 for diabetics, and 3 for the elderly above 75 years old and pregnant women. Those are the hypertensive and the lipid lowering medication, which is just as important as the insulin or other diabetic medications. 70% is reimbursed again for elderly patients in Poland. In Germany, 5 minimum, 10 maximum. Norway, 39% of the cost. And in Spain, again, 10% of the cost, up to a maximum of 4.13. In terms of the ophthalmologic treatment, fundoscopy, surgery, lasers, surgeries, anything like that, fully reimbursed in every country. And Norway, it's a deductible up to after 375 crowns. The metabolic surgery, it's mostly reimbursed in every country, but Germany gives you the additional stipulation that the BMI has to be above 40. We also saw this covered in the Polish presentation. And in Norway, again, a deductible of 375. Now, for the price of insulin, in the market, we have various different types of insulin, rapid acting, basal, and human mixed, each with every advantage and disadvantage. But now we're just focusing on the price. For Poland, it's 21 euros for patients, 21 euros normally, 1 for patients, and 0 for elderly patients. In Germany, it's around 50 euros, but for patients, 5.18. And in Norway, it's 28.48. Now, this brand here, Actrapid, is not fully covered under the national campaign for Spain, so the price is usually higher, 36.45, and people, instead of getting 10% of the price, will get around 60 to 40%, depending on the socioeconomic background. We can see this pattern repeat with the basal insulin, which has a very similar type to the price to the tip basal insulin. And the human mixed insulin is by far the most expensive, with higher cost per less amount of pence. We have 115 base cost in Poland, but around 45 euros or zero, depending on the status of the patient. 74.35 for the patient for normal people and 7.44 for the patient. In Norway, again, a discount of around 60%, and in Spain, 60 to 40%, depending on the socioeconomic status. Now, finally, I would like to mention the different drugs, like the GSP1 receptor inhibitors, the Flozis, and the DPP4s. Unfortunately, we could not add them into this presentation due to the fact that they're relatively new, from 15 to 5 years, which means that there is no reliable sources that tell us how much is reimbursed with every drug, and so we decided not to include them. Finally, I'd like to thank all of the people that contributed to this project, and again, the faculty for giving us the privilege of presenting this, and all of you for your attention. Thank you.
Anessa, Danielle, thank you very much for this comprehensive review of the reimbursement policies. You did a really great job. Thank you again. You are fantastic. Thank you.
Proszę Państwa, konferencja nasza dzisiaj jest dość długa, jesteśmy już troszkę zmęczeni, ale nadal czekamy z niecierpliwością na tę część dyskusyjną, ponieważ na czacie mamy wiele pytań tutaj do naszych ekspertów. So we are delighted with the excellent presentations and now it is our pleasure to invite Professor Leszek Czupryniak to chair the discussion. Poświęćmy jeszcze chwilę na dyskusję.
Thank you very much. The questions are not that many questions, so don't worry, we won't spend another hour here. Rather, I could talk on one slide for 1 hour, of course, as you can see. The questions are in Polish and in English. I'll try to translate them and direct them in both, either direction, and direct them to the relevant speakers. Doesn't look nice, but the first one is directed to me. What happened to semaglutide injections and what to do with a patient who has no drug for the therapy? That's what I said. The drug is in US. I stopped prescribing Ozempic, basically, semaglutide injections, because patients can't buy it. I tell them that, well, you have to find a patient who has just bought it and simply kill him or steal it from him, otherwise we won't get it. But the option, there are two options. One option is to use to switch patients from semaglutide to dulaglutide, which is Trulicity. If it is about diabetes, the effect is more or less the same. If it is about obesity, dulaglutide is somewhat weaker, but also gives weight loss. You can also change it into oral semaglutide, Rybelsus. In selected pharmacies, it costs as much as Ozempic, which is without reimbursement, which is 80 euro per month, more or less. And the Ozempic will be unavailable at that rate, as we are told, until the end of the year. So it won't change quickly. Then another question is in general about GLP-1s, and maybe Dr. Brzozowicz would try to attempt it. The latest research on bariatric surgery, did they use control groups with patients on GLP-1 analogs? So are there any studies comparing parallelly GLP-1 analog treatment with bariatric surgery, and how we could expect the results of such a comparison if it hasn't been done?
To be honest with you, I don't have an in-depth knowledge about such studies. I'm however familiar that a lot of practitioners try to pre-treat their patients with GLP-1 analogs prior to undergoing the bariatric surgery because of likely enhancing the hormonal reactions as well as to promote the weight loss, which is necessary for such bariatric surgery to be done, especially in patients who have severe obesity, because the weight loss is a requirement prior to undergoing bariatric surgery to shrink the liver to be able to do a proper surgery. In terms of what I can actually comment about is discussed efficacy in a slide by my predecessor, as well as data which I'm familiar with, which discuss weight loss with bariatric surgery. What we could see, then on average medical therapy results, if it's being continued and if a patient is compliant with it, because we need to acknowledge that some patients can't tolerate these medications because, for example, of gastrointestinal side effects or contraindication to such medications, such as previous pancreatitis, etc., results on average between 15 to 18% of the total body weight loss. From what I understand, the bariatric surgery is still much more efficacious. And what we should think about is that a lot of patients who undergo bariatric surgery, they have really a severe obesity with BMI over 40, which in a lot of cases means the weight they will start with would be, for example, between 100 to 150 kilos. And then, you know, when we look at the relative reduction of their body weight, these 15 or 18% in reality, I'm sorry, I'm here contradicting, contradicting a bit a conclusion from your discussion that bariatric surgery will be gone and GLP-1 analogs will replace it, on which I will disagree, because in reality, if we're seeing a patient who comes to our surgery who has a baseline weight between, you know, 120 to 150 kilos, then you know, reduction which you can achieve with a GLP-1 analog, if taken when well and if it's continued, then as a practicing endocrinologist, I do see non-compliance with this medication is not that great. And so I still do think that the bariatric surgery has its place despite these modern therapies.
Yeah, it will have its place, but I would argue simply the number of patients who will refer to bariatric surgery will be just smaller, lower. And of course, when GLP-1s are ineffective, they could help. There is one clear advantage of surgery. You do it once, and it's over. And it's one-time treatment. Of course, you follow up the patient, you supplement vitamins and so on. With GLP-1s, you have to take it all the time. Yeah. Once you stop it, there is a regain in weight. So that's the downside of this.
I would certainly think that GLP-1 analogs, a treatment with GLP-1 analogs, would be an excellent enhancement of the effects of a bariatric surgery.
We combine it, absolutely.
And a lot of patients will... We add GLP-1s
after bariatric surgery.
And we prior to the surgery as well.
We have to learn how to use all these options together. And I guess we will not have enough studies. We'll have to base our decisions on just clinical knowledge. There is a question about empagliflozin, which I showed. Have the results been replicated? Yes, they have been with other drugs. And meta-analysis basically shows that SGLT2 inhibitors, apart from this cardiovascular mortality effect, are really more or less the same. So if you have no empagliflozin, it's better to use any SGLT2 inhibitor. It will do much of the work. There is again a question, when there is no Ozempic, what's better, oral semaglutide or dulaglutide? Well, whichever works, I would try either of them. With oral semaglutide is one small catch. You have to take it once daily, early in the morning, before any other meal or drug. You drink it with glass of water, and you have to wait half an hour before having a meal or other drugs. The pill, and as I already said, it's a revolution as well. The pill with semaglutide, we cannot swallow proteins because they will simply be degraded by acid in the stomach. But the pill where semaglutide is put in simply changes the pH of the stomach where it falls on the part of the stomach, makes it neutral, and that's why drug is safely absorbed. And there is a question to Dr. Marzec. You said about insulin resistance, the debate or the dilemma between insulin resistance preceding hyperinsulinemia or hyperinsulinemia leading to insulin resistant. Could it be that these effects are just coexisting, and it's just like a vicious circle? It may start with insulin resistance, lead to hyperinsulinemia, which will exacerbate insulin resistance, and so on and so on. Could it be not dichotomic, but could it be in fact the same phenomenon? We simply catch it or measure it at a different stage of development. That's how I understand the question.
So the answer would be very quick, yes. Yes, it is. It is absolutely possible. Everyone would like to find what starts that. Where is the tipping point when the wheel starts one to another feeding of each other? So they can happen almost in the same time. Do we have tools to distinguish them? Probably not. We use animal models, but they are not easily translatable to humans, or we are not sure if they are. So we basically see only effects of that. And then of course, there is a question of what is an insulin resistance, because functionally that should be measured on an individual cell's response to insulin and how much of the signaling is inside of the cells. That's basically functionally what it is. And the way that we measure it is injecting ourselves with insulin and glucose and different versions of that, and trying to understand if the profiles are representing of insulin, as we call it, insulin resistance or not. So basically from the laboratory perspective or research scientific perspective, really we don't know what it is. We only see the correlation, functional correlation. So it's very difficult to say which one is first, and because we don't know about one of them what it really is, and if that really exists. There are some studies that show that, well, not some, there's only one from the last year, when the pancreas of the deceased people, pancreases or biopsies are stained, when it shows that, for example, proinsulin is present in higher levels than in the healthy individuals from people who will later on develop type 1 diabetes. So we know that certain things, and we have the data that, for example, this magical insulin resistance was not detected. But those are low number studies, so there's no definite answer at all.
Yeah, clinically, it's all fascinating. Proinsulin was for years suspected of being proatherogenic, not really confirmed. It's like, proinsulin to me is like elephant in the room. I mean, we know it's there, but we simply disregard its action. We are not really concentrated. As you said, it's not been officially crystallized, which is another interesting thing.
No, I think the problem with insulin, we probably have enough blood samples from people to actually answer many questions. What we don't have and what we don't use is very technical, is the antibodies that detect insulin and proinsulin and how they distinguish between those two. So every antibody that detects insulin also detects proinsulin. You have to develop, and there's only one existing right now on the market, antibody that detects specifically proinsulin but not insulin. This is not used in technical laboratories that evaluate that. So we refer it to insulin, but we are referring to both, to the prohormone too. So we have the samples, we don't have the tools, or at least the tools are not used. The antibody is, I think, 2 years old only.
I guess there is something to discover there which will surprise us a lot, and it perhaps in the near future. Well, other questions are more or less repeating what we've already discussed, so I think you may conclude the discussion, especially that we are probably a little bit over time. So thank you very much for your talks and answers, and thanks for giving me this opportunity to chair this little part.
Thank you, Professor. Szanowni Państwo, pięknie dziękujemy naszym wybitnym prelegentom, dzięki którym mogliśmy dziś wysłuchać tak fantastycznych wystąpień. Dziękujemy również Państwu, naszym słuchaczom, szczególnie tym z Państwa, którzy dotrwali do końca, jak również słuchaczom podłączonym online.
This was an amazing afternoon. We would like to express our sincere thanks to the organizers and in particular to our honorable speakers. All of them have been working with us since the beginning of the planning stage. And they are here today, even though they are very busy with their responsibilities. This program could not have been made possible without the contribution of International Federation of Medical Students Association, our local student scientific community, Escolab, and Polish Diabetology Association. Aleksandra, Mateusz, dziękujemy bardzo. We truly appreciate your dedication.
We believe that all of us, both participating here and connected online, benefited significantly from this event. And we hope we can see you again the next year. Thank you very much and have a nice evening in Kielce. Dziękujemy bardzo.